This episode of An Unexpected Podcast is brought to you by Devin Odell. Thank you. Hello, friends, and welcome to An Unexpected Podcast. I'm Ez.
And I'm Lane.
And we're talking Tolkien.
We're coming to you from the Shire of America, the beautiful state of Ohio, and a little village called Amanda.
This week, we'll be covering A Journey in the Dark as a part of our journey through Middle Earth.
And as fate would allow, right, as we're about to journey in the dark, and it's shining bright outside.
It is the first time. I know.
We have not paralleled a chapter.
It's
unnerving, so maybe that's good.
It's my fault.
No, it's just...
But it is weird, right?
Things are better left for the day.
Would we wanted to have podcasted about this in the dark?
I don't think so. Something might have happened. We may have delved too greedily and too deep.
True.
Something could have been awoken.
Yeah.
I don't know.
And it's not just like a normal dark. I mean, it's...
No.
Dark.
You're right.
Like,
it's supernatural dark.
Like, even in this chapter, at one point, like, just a tidbit of light here, boys.
Yep.
You know, cast a little light up. All right, bring it right on back.
I think he and Gimli and maybe even a little bit of Frodo are the only ones that can see.
Yeah.
Suffocating.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy.
Yikes.
So, you're back from vacation.
I am back. Yes, we both returned from distant journeys, and we're here to stay now.
Yeah. You don't have any more planned? You're not leaving me next week?
No. We had a great time, though. The best part, obviously, we've always had fun when we go up there, but this was the most fun we've ever had going up to Canada, and we did fishing, and like I said before, Sarah's family has done this for like 40 years, same place, same trip, same route to get there and everything, but this was Winnie's first time, so it was really cool. She is everyone's like, 6 months, how's she going to travel? And we were, worried about it. We didn't know.
Oh, for sure,
She was amazing, traveled so well, better than me. She was more patient than I was, had a lot of fun up there. So yeah, but it's always good getting home. But it was the first time I think I've ever been on a trip where I wasn't like aching to get home by day three.
Yeah,
normally day three I'm like, I just want to go back to the Shire, and this time I told Sarah, I said, apart from Arwen not being with us, our family was together.
Yeah,
and maybe that's part of it. I was like, when he's here, What else do I need?
Yeah, that's where home's at, right?
Right.
Well, yeah. It looked beautiful. The pictures it you was, sent me. You dude, sent me one picture. I could not believe the greens and the blue. I was like, what? It's just,
dude. And when you get up there too, I was trying to think. I was on the boat. It was last night we were there. Everyone else was in sweatshirts and pants. Like my wife's grandpa and she were both like hooded up because it was really, really cold.
Really?
Yeah. I was in rugby shorts and a t-shirt.
Yeah.
And I was just soaking it up because I'd heard. Had contact with mom. She said, it's really hot back here at home. It feels terrible. It's gross.
It was boiling.
Yeah. And we're up there, and it was probably mid-60s on the water.
Wow.
And I remember, I was like, man, I feel slightly cold. But then I was like, this sudden heat came into my heart, and I was like, everyone at home is dying of heat.
Yeah.
I'm going to be back in this 90-plus degree weather. And right now, I'm in the cold. That feels great.
That's awesome.
But I was trying to think about what it compares to in terms of Middle Earth. And it's kind of like if an old forest met, if there was a giant lake in the middle of old forest instead of the Withywindle, that's what that area would be like. I mean, just super old, thick, dense forests.
Yeah. Well, and you're also up north, right? It's cooler up there.
Yep. So. It got dark at like 11 o'clock at night.
That's crazy.
Gets light at like 4. We saw a wolf. Which was kind of cool.
Yeah.
First time we've ever seen a wolf up there, so that was pretty sweet on the way out. And
wow, did you actually...
Saw some loons.
Oh, really?
Oh, they're beautiful loons, and then they had little chicks on them, too. They usually have, like, two at a time, and they're on their back. They're the most beautiful. Like, their calls are haunting, but they are the most beautiful birds, man.
Huh.
Red eyes.
Wow.
Black with, like, stripes.
That's
gorgeous.
Cool.
Yeah.
That's really cool. Did you actually catch any fish? Did you guys?
We did. Yeah. We
cut them up and you.
Yeah. We eat them there. And... We brought some home too, actually.
Wow.
So we'll have to give you some. It's really good. Walleye is what we're catching. It's delicious.
Nice.
Yeah. So back from travels, man.
That's
glad
awesome.
To be here though. Glad to be with you. I missed you.
I miss you too, man.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
Yeah. What have you been up to?
Well, guys, I actually had a little bit of a situation last week.
Kerfuffle.
Yeah. So if I sound a little funny, I always sound a little funny, don't I?
You know, we both do.
A little weird.
We're hobbits.
but I had like my face was like super swollen last week.
I had got like, cut open.
I got cut open. Yeah, on the left side of my face, and I've got like numbing solution in there and stuff. I had to I had to get like this little, it's kind of gross, but I had to get like this like fluid removed off the side of my, you know, neck slash jaw. It really hurt, actually. So I'm okay. We're good.
I think, but the Witch King just kind of missed your shoulder, went up for the neck.
Yeah, really. So it just hurt. I got some, you know, some bruising or whatever there and stuff, but we're all good.
You look pretty cool, dude.
Yeah. So, but battle. Hey, so while you were up there on vacation, I was just like chilling with my headgear on my couch, just open. Watching the World Cup, you know.
We're going to try to miss this nerve so you can feel things the rest of your life, but if we don't,
yeah,
did our best.
Yeah, we did our best. Yeah. Sorry, fella. Oh, man. So,
that's great. We got a lot to talk about today, though, don't we?
We do. We got a lot to get into. One quick update for the show. I actually just got off the phone on the way here with Traxler. And so I would have had this ordered last week while you were on vacation, but I was in headgear and dealing with the whole, you know, feeling whatever, recovering from the swelling. And I talked to him. Place the order on Friday, and for the t-shirts and our other swag that we're going to do for Patreon. Dude, I think we're going to get a pretty high-quality t-shirt.
I can't wait for these tees. So,
yeah, I talked to him, and I was like, look, like of everything you guys have ever done for me, I was like, this seems to be like the best.
Yeah.
And like, okay, so like they sent me like 5 different samples. You know, I looked at the different shirts.
Whoa, you've seen them?
Yeah, when I even stopped in today. That's why I was a
little late. Shut up, dude.
Well, no, I haven't seen the actual like print. I saw the t-shirt itself because you wanted like a lighter gray.
Yeah.
And so they had that charcoal heather, but I was I think Lane wanted something a little lighter, and so they pulled out some. They went deep.
Wow.
Yeah.
And like pictures or anything? I'm dying.
Yeah,
I'm dying for these shirts, man. Oh my gosh.
And so they look pretty cool. I wanted something pre-shrunk, you know, real nice. And the cotton. Screen printing, it's just 10 times better. It'll last longer. So they're gonna take our logo, and their design team's gonna kind of like, Just do it up a little bit so that way it kind of looks like, you know, ingrained in the shirt type of thing. So,
oh my gosh. They're going to
be good. Once they get it done, this first batch,
oh my gosh,
then I can just go back to them for future batches and should be no problem. So,
wow. So, guys, we have...
It's exciting.
Yeah, we've also been talking about packaging. We've been looking at... We've taken some inspiration from Swish and Flick.
Yeah.
Right? They do an awesome job of presentation, and we just hadn't really thought. We're like, how are we going to ship this stuff out?
Shout out real quick to Megan and Katie because they do all of the... You know, all of that good stuff for Swish and Flick, and you know, they kind of tip me off on some neat ways to ship you guys some stuff.
Yeah.
It's all in the packaging. I didn't realize
it's all in the packaging. And I think we're going to actually, we haven't talked to her yet, but she knows that we would like her to make more stickers for us. We're going to talk to Katie Serva and see if she can make some stickers that we can throw on there and maybe even throw in those troll hordes or swag bags or whatever they're called.
Yeah. I actually have a couple those Bill the Pony stickers. Remember, you were doing a count the other day?
Yes.
I actually have some.
Okay, perfect. So we're going to, and we'd like to.
Sorry, guys, live business.
Hello. Welcome to the guts. We have some stuff that we've, you know, obviously she's made those two stickers, Bill the Pony and then also the Silent Fox that we've bought, and we've thought, hey, maybe we could throw a couple of those in too or whatever, support her art, and that way you guys get it too. And
other surprises that I don't want to mention on the podcast.
Ezra's underwear.
I want you to.
I got the golden ticket.
Oh, God. Could you imagine?
Don't really want to sniff it. No,
MeUndies.
I don't.
MeUndies.
I got an Ezra's undies.
All right. Here we go. So, anyways, enough of the quick counsel.
What is this again? What show are we on?
Yeah, not sure anymore, to be honest with you. But you can check all
TV
that. Hop into the tier on patreon.com/ Uptalking Tolkien.
Yep.
You guys can get in there and get all that goodness. Okay. Dropping eaves, my friend.
Yeah. Yes. Let's get into it here. So, show news, movie news.
Yeah.
Hasn't been a whole lot of, what do you call it? Groundbreaking discoveries since the last time we talked.
Yeah.
But, math is not my strong subject. I started putting one and two together there.
Yes.
Okay. And I was like, oh, dude, you know what's coming up?
Uh-huh.
Is Comic-Con International in San Diego.
Right.
And I was like, if there's going to be any big announcements, especially since the deal just closed, and then also with the Tolkien biopic, they're probably going to wait until the biggest geek out celebration of the year, which is at Comic-Con in San Diego.
Yeah.
Which, hey, by the way, we should go to one of these years.
Oh, I would love to.
Can you imagine us sitting there for a panel for the TV show?
That'd be insane.
Okay.
That'd be insane.
Like I just looked in the Palantir, peeking in the Palantir there, bud. So anyway, we'll probably get a lot more. Many more nuggets to kind of jewels to, you know, discuss over about the show and the biopic.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So really nothing there. Again, no more news on the biopic. You know, it's just,
what if you just came out and said, like, I heard they're scrapping the show. Would you? I just. Oh, no, I'd lose my mind. Why did I even say that?
I don't know.
You just.
If can you imagine?
Yeah, that would be terrible.
Why did you say that?
Because you do this sometimes, and I was like, Wade just throws these curveballs out here.
Random things out. Now I'm slightly nervous.
So, I'm just kidding.
Oh, boy.
Ez okay. knows nothing. I'm not in the know, so we're good. I leave all that dropping
goodness
stuff
for that, right? Jeez, if we were on the know.
Okay.
Bad news. Okay.
Other corners?
Yes, we do have some. I was just pulling something up there real quick. Excuse me. So let me get switched over here.
Yeah.
Yes. We actually got a crazy Bywater post V-mail. That's just what I'm pulling up. That was something I forgot to do before the show. Before
oh, we that's started fine.
Podcasting here, so I'm gonna play it
while you're pulling that up. Then you know the well, I don't know if you're gonna talk about this or not, but the group, something special happened in the group.
Tons of stuff. What?
Tons of stuff. We had our 200th.
Yes, we did. Number. Shelby. Yeah, Shelby is our 200th upper to join the group. So that is really exciting. That just happened today.
It happened today, yeah.
Or so a week ago. Whatever, yeah. Whenever you're listening to this.
I mean, 5 hours ago, you posted it, so.
I meant because it's done in the past. You know.
Wow. All right. Yeah.
Ooh.
We're together today, so.
Yes, we are. So you know what?
Actually sitting across from each other.
Like, I am, yeah.
In the same room together.
It's just sort of confusing here. I'm going to play this through my phone into the microphone because... Mr. Smith's here having some difficulties.
Oh, you're good. You can just go ahead and unplug it. You're fine. It's gonna make a little bit of noise, but who cares? Yeah,
okay. We'll do that.
Yeah, I mean, listen, man. I get this. I know how to do some magical stuff in post edit. Okay,
which this is will actually be cut out.
Which is no, which is actually ironic that I said, because like most of the time I say that and then I just leave it in, which I'm going to right now.
Let me just go through and I'm gonna read the polls first. Okay. So. We have a couple polls to catch up on. The council was closed. We had our fellowship draft of doom.
Yeah, let me Guys, go ahead and read was, these results. Let
this
me,
was sort of disappointing. Because, I'm kind of disappointed in a lot of you, to
well,
be honest.
I'm not. I'll be honest with you guys. I had full faith. Here's the thing, when you pick a good team, people know. Okay,
is that how it goes?
You know, there's I don't know.
I think there's just a love affair going on with Ezra Kirk in this world. And I voted for you too.
I'm not mad at it.
I'm saying minus points for hubris because you voted for yourself as well. Some people say, it's confidence.
Did
confidence.
I vote for him
Yeah,
myself?
You did. Yeah, you did. You little charlatan. Right. You know, when you're up by 30 points in a poll.
Okay, hold on.
You go ahead and you vote for the other
guy. In fairness, I was worried because like the week before, everyone was killing me in the comments. They're like,
yeah,
you know,
that's a good
like,
point.
Oh, Ez is
you
should
have been sweating.
Ez
you
is done. Sweating. Ez is done. But I said round two, I had in the bag. I knew that I did. And you know where I think I sealed it? Sorry, I'm just going to be a little braggadocious here.
You
was with Faramir. Faramir and Boromir.
Yeah. And
I think that's actually, people were kind
of
like.
Know, I think that connection got a lot of attention, but I'm not really sure.
How well it would do in the actual.
No, I do. I just think, you know, I think I had some pretty cool connections too. I think that.
I'm not going to take it. So
no, but actually, I did stop and think about that. And I was like, you know what? That would be pretty massive. If they could cool. kind of. What's the word? Sort of temper each other.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Or I guess maybe Faramir really pulled Boromir more towards the light. That would be a pretty
be cool.
Be a hard team to.
Well,
to
and
go
also
up against.
let's say Boromir went out the same way, and Faramir, you know, had to see his brother go. You know, and like maybe Boromir makes that sacrifice, and Faramir is a part of like helping the other hobbits get away.
Yeah.
Wow. You're talking about an emotional, you know.
Yeah.
Thing there. Anyways. The results are, so Team Wizards 68% and Team New Zealand 32%.
I think we should read the comments, though, because I mean, there's some pretty good comments. Michael Upshaw, I mean, I know I love you, dude. He said, New Zealand all the way. Aragorn, Sam, Tom, and Radagast, they'll be melting rings all day. I love Gwa here, too. And I think the only better pick for the Beast of Burden would be the Wolf. Mm. And then he... posted a gif of a picture meme of I think it's Jack Nicholson mm-hmm. as the Wolf or Harvey Keitel. I don't know the okay. reference, but I was like, cool, dude, the Wolf.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Of Wall Street or something. I don't know.
Nice, that's cool, Michael. You know,
I'm having some technical difficulties here.
You're fine. Tish actually said, awesome picks, Ezra. Your fellowship is balanced in power, skill, and strength. I agree.
Mm-hmm. And predictability. Oh,
what?
Ouch! I said, and in predictability.
Okay, sure. But the quest is going to be arduous, but they're all going to make it, freeing the Southerlands from evil as they go. So thank you, Tish. Appreciate that. So, yeah, I don't know.
We've got another poll to go through as well.
Oh, yeah.
In the depths of winter, which seemingly superpower would you rather have to get through the snow? Comparing the elf way versus the way of man versus a write-in, starting a fire from nothing, the wizard way. So, you know, just thinking about the different ways they got through the snow, which I was fascinated by. I fixated on it.
Yeah.
Walking atop the snow got 85%. Plowing through the snow, 15%.
I was one of the 15.
I was too.
Yeah.
So why did you pick it?
Well, I just think it's, I don't know. It's neat. Like, if I were there, I'd have been like, put it on my back. Put one of those hobbits on my back. I got this. I will plow. You know, I got a broad chest.
Yeah.
Let me just have at this snow.
For me, I was like, I know how tired I get when I shovel snow on my sidewalk. So I would love the feeling of being able to just push it through, and then they go back and they carry the hobbits through.
Yeah.
I mean, they were tired, but not really.
Well, it's just
an incredible strength.
Yeah, it was cool. Yeah.
Yeah. I would love to experience that.
So
we had some comments that sort of went along with that as well. Christopher Michael said, of the two options, walking on top of it. But the ability to just melt the crap out of my way is definitely higher on the list.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, sure.
Mm-hmm.
Susie Milhouse says, I agree. Walking on top would be great, but conjuring fire out of nothing would definitely be my top pick. That'd be pretty awesome. Yeah. Tish Monson, after the massive snowstorms we got last winter, I would like to plow through without tiring and thus making a path for others.
Mm-hmm.
Kindness along the way, too. I like that. James West, the wizard way for sure.
There you go, James.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
Jeremy Price, I'd have to seriously lay off my dwarven diet if I were to even attempt to walk on top of the snow, but that's my pick. So kind of cool to imagine one of those powers.
That's pretty cool. So,
yeah. So, okay. Finally got it dug out of the, I'm talking about snow. I think it was buried in some snow in the Bywater Post. I'm sorry. So anyway, like I said at the beginning of, you know, keeping this episode short.
Right.
at the beginning of Other Corners here, we got a really strange voicemail that we wanted to share. I don't know how I feel about this, Ez. Maybe this is where the kind of real life is paralleling the chapter. Well, should we just go ahead and listen to it?
Yeah, let's go ahead and
Go ahead and play.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
To risky thieves. They stole it from us. Kill them. Kill them both. Quiet. Mustn't wake them. Mustn't ruin it now. But they knows. They knows. They suspect us. What's it saying, my precious, my love? Is Smeagol losing his nerve? No. Not. Never. Smeagol hates nasty hobbitses. Smeagol wants to see them dead. And we will. Smeagol did it once. He can do it again. It's ours. Ours. We must get the precious. We must get it back. Patience. Patience, my love. First, we must lead them to her. We lead them to the winding stars. Yes. The stars. And then, up the stairs we go. Then we come to the tunnel. And when we go in, there's no coming out. She's always hungry. She always needs the feed. She must eat, or she gets us further hoaxes. They don't taste very nice, does they, precious? No, not very nice at all, my love. She hungers for sweeter meats. Hobbit meat. And when she throws away the bones and empty clothes, then we will find it and take it from me. For us. Yes. You meant for us. Golem. The precious will be ours once the hobbitses are dead.
So you can imagine kind of our... That was not a clip from the film. That was in our voicemail. So
yeah,
I guess Gollum kind of sharing his Tolkien story in a way.
Stay tuned for more on that.
There's actually more
at the end.
Yeah, more to that story that will be shared in Bywater Post.
Yeah, my goodness.
Kind of unsettling. I don't know how he got our number, but...
Yeah, for real.
Anyway.
Okay.
Real quick, one more thing in other kernels of Middle-earth, other corners of Middle-earth, we have something to kind of share. So one of these, we have several goals for our book club that we've set out and we've discussed over the past 7 months now. Holy cow, dude.
Yeah.
This was one that Ez and I kind of spitballed way back in like, what, February or March? Was it even before that?
God, it might have been before that. It was right around the beginning of all of this.
It was, wasn't
you,
it?
You had the idea.
It was just a spark, and then we kind of talked about it.
Important dates and stuff. You
yes,
know?
Yes, we were. So, anyway, September 22nd is on a Saturday this year, right? It's a very important day. It's Bilbo and Frodo's birthday. It's our main characters, and this whole story kind of revolves around that date in a way. It's a special day.
Yeah.
So we thought it'd be kind of cool to celebrate that day.
Yeah.
Kind of cool to have a little party.
Right.
One of these goals we had is eventually someday we'd love to have a Lord of the Rings event.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right.
We would.
Lord of the Rings event. There's medieval Renaissance fairs. There's Comic Cons. There's all these things that dance around like a Lord of the Rings day. But at least in our part of the world, in our part of the country, there is no Middle Earth celebration specific for Tolkien.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So we are going to start our own. We are holding a long expected party this September 22nd, which is a Saturday. We're going to start it at 2. We were kind of going back and forth on how we should do this. Like, we're going to keep it low key. It's going to be a very simple party. It's being held right here in the Shire of America, a little village called Amanda, in a backyard of Bag End. And so it's not going to be anything extravagant to start off. It's going to be small and simple. We actually debated on whether we should even kind of talk about it in the book club, or whether we should just, because we're going to do some things that we'll record and play
for sure
on the book club and the podcast. And we were like, should we, you know, just should we tell our friends about it then, or should we tell them about it before? So anyway, we've got an invitation list of people that are close by that are our friends that we know, that we knew before the book club.
Mm-hmm.
But we also wanted to say, if you're in the area, if you're within driving distance, and you'd like to come, you are invited.
Yeah.
So maybe what you could do is, if you plan on, if you're free that day and you live in Pennsylvania, live in Ohio, live in Illinois, whatever, Michigan, and you want to come out and join in a long-expected party.
Yeah.
Share your Tolkien story in person. Have some, I think we're going to be having afternoon tea, dinner, and supper. We're going to be having a potato competition.
Yeah.
Competition for your favorite potato dish.
Yep.
That we and a special guest will judge.
Yeah.
There will be an interactive special guest there who will be very exciting. I'm not even going to announce that yet, but that'll be pretty cool. We'll have some music. We'll have some Middle Earth riddles that we'll share, kind of like a trivia type thing.
Yeah, yeah.
What else? We'll have golf and ball. We'll have Farmer Maggot's crop toss, which is you know.
Well, I mean, and you can come dressed up. People can
that's right.
Whatever you want,
costumes.
You know, as much if you just want to wear a Lord of the Rings T-shirt, that's fine too. You know,
want to bring your cape and your staff. That's cool too.
Yeah. So I just think it's pretty neat, and it is starting off just here in your backyard, and then if it grows.
That's the hope, isn't it?
That's the hope. We find a nice big tree in a field, and we throw up some lights and and have a little, you know, bash.
Yep. So, So anyway, here's what you could do. If you're interested in coming, and it'd be great to have some heads up so we can plan for you.
Yeah.
Shoot us an email.
Yeah.
Or just a message.
And honestly, if you're coming from far away too, that's fine. There's we always talk about Amanda. Honestly, directly across from Lane's place is a bed and breakfast. Right across the street. I mean, literally where you see Ez park his car sometimes, directly across the way is a beautiful little bread and bed and breakfast. And there's places in Lancaster, which is less than 10 minutes away.
Yeah.
You know, so if you wanted to stay and then come over and hang out for the day. And if you did make that effort, you know, it's on a Saturday, but
we talked about going out for brunch on Sunday.
We talked about having drinks Friday.
Yeah.
Having the shindig
party on Saturday and then brunch on Sunday too. So if you do come from out of town, from far away, and you'll be staying the night, we'll be sure to get together and make it worthwhile for sure. So Anyway, exciting and kind of humble beginnings, but our hope is that eventually, you know, maybe there'll be a Middle Earth convention right here in Ohio. Yeah.
And I will say, if you can't make it, I have a couple really nice cameras, tripods I'm going to set up in two corners of the backyard.
Yep.
And I'm just going to vlog the whole thing.
Yep.
Have some mics, people can come up and tell their stories.
We'll create like a highlight reel, won't we?
Yeah, yeah. So yeah. There, if you're worried about not, you can't make it or whatever, no big deal.
Yeah.
We're going to post it on our Facebook and on our YouTube page and kind of go from there.
Yeah. So. Very exciting. Okay, so I think that wraps it up. A lot there. Sorry about that, but
no, we're
some good stuff to share. So yeah,
good to get through.
Yeah.
All right. So let's dive into the reread this week. As I said, we're talking about we're in book 2, chapter 4, A Journey in the Dark.
Yeah.
And last week we had a couple, you know, since Liam was on vacation, we kind of recorded those earlier. We have a comment from Christopher Michael from the Council of Elrond Part 2 we wanted to kind of talk about. Mm-hmm. Then we've also got a comment for The Ring Goes South. Christopher just said, you know, to be fair, Saruman, for a minute back when he was telling them the ring was either lost in the ocean or destroyed, he was already hooked by it and trying to find it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so
it is important to remember. Yeah,
yeah,
he
it
was,
is.
You know, part of the reason
his betrayal, because I think someone asked the question, you know, when did his betrayal start?
Yeah.
You know, and
yeah, that's right.
It had started, you know, back
long,
then,
yeah, long,
a long
yeah,
time
long before.
Ago.
Yeah. And probably the reason he was downplaying it was because he himself was searching for it.
Yeah.
Right. And,
yep.
and wanting to obtain that. So any way he could discredit that threat would be good for him.
Yeah. One more thing too, that Christopher brought up. He had a really good, piece on, I don't have it in front of me, but on Glorfindel and his return.
Yeah. Yeah. That's right. Know, he did. Yeah.
Really good.
Kind of his history. Yeah.
Yeah. If you go take a look at that, just some artwork and then some verbiage there, but I thought it actually really kind of told Glorfindel's tale mm-hmm. pretty well. And just go look up on Tolkien Gateway. You can learn a lot more about him. We're going to be covering that in our histories series on Patreon soon too. So, okay. The Ring Goes South. Luca.
Yeah, Lucas says, I was seriously surprised that in the book, no oath was made by the members of the Fellowship. In the movie, it looks like they are super confident to go with Frodo, sword, bow, axe, I'll do anything for you, bromance stuff. Very true. And in the books, it turns out, well, they didn't really mean to go with Frodo all the way. Only Frodo must take the ring. The others are like, well, they go until the mountains, maybe a little further. Aragorn and Boromir cuts mm-hmm. to Gondor. It's strange. It is a huge difference from the movie. Again, I think maybe just because the film had to be a lot quicker, had to set a different tone that way. It's interesting, in the extended edition, though, Elrond does say, on you who go with the ring bearer, no oath nor bond is laid to go further than you will. Actually, I was just watching that today.
Yeah.
And it's an interesting little addition they made that kind of acknowledges that fact, I think.
Right,
like a book nod to the book there. But yeah, it's this thing like it's Frodo's task.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not their task. They're there to help. And you're right, it is kind of like Aragorn and
doesn't that make it that much more like epic?
It does.
That really it is Frodo's task.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, some people, and I think maybe Luca might be kind of hinting at that, does it lessen the Fellowship now?
Sure.
I mean, it can in a way, but... Because in the movies, it is real strong. You know, it's this
instant, I'm with you.
I'm with you. Yeah. You have my axe, my bow, all that good stuff, my sword. And in this, it's you learn that really Aragorn is going, this is what he's been prepping for his whole life. He's going to go back to Gondor and lead, you know, men to victory.
Right.
He's going to go with Boromir.
Yep.
So.
I almost think it makes it stronger or more moving because they don't have to stick around. And you look at what happens, and Aragorn still does go to Gondor, but it's in a less direct way, right? They're more, and by the end, they're more bound to the Fellowship, and that desire to help each other, and that becomes their motivation.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. It's almost like it does break, but there are like cords of it that continue on.
Well, strands. I love how Elrond sometimes will mention that, you know, even he can't see. Mm-hmm. All the things that may need to happen.
Yeah.
You know, because, you know, they decide to take Pippin and Merry over Elrond. I mean, Elrond was considering two other people from his house. So it's sort of like there's no guarantee here.
Right.
They got to throw this together and Gandalf wants to trust in their friendship.
Yeah.
And truly it is the friendship between Sam and Frodo that really gets us all the way there.
It is. And even if you think about the when you think about Merry and Pippin, and then being taken.
Yeah.
That directs the course of the three
yes,
as well.
It does.
And that draws in another factor in Rohan. down the road.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
maybe that, I mean, that maybe was under they, the, it was under control of Saruman. Maybe that would have been lost.
Yeah, exactly. I don't
you know, they, it's just, it's a ripple effect, isn't it?
It is. Yeah. Yeah. So it's just kind of neat. That's why it's fun to go back and, as we have in the group, speculate on what how things would have been different, you know?
That's amazing.
So
very realistic that way. Very realistic.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. So, okay. So let's go. I'll jump into the recap here. The ring goes south. Basically, after the council meeting, the hobbits, this is from, last week, Merry and Pippin are a little offended. Sam gets chosen, you know, it is what it is. They remained in Rivendell for 2 months. This is a decent sized chapter. They got to scout the way. Yeah. We find out that Gandalf and Aragorn have had like a back and forth discussion on, you know, which way should we take, you know?
Yep.
And they try to go over Caradhras, and it just doesn't work out. The mountain's against them, you know, and they have to choose a different path. So they're in the, it's, what is it, Holland? They're in Holland, right?
Yep.
So they're in the ruins there of Holland, and the spies. They had some spies. Yeah. They had to, you know, evade those.
Yeah, the Crabine.
Yeah,
Dunland. Yep. Yeah, yep, the crows. So, yep.
But then, they once they're turned back and they make their way through the snow, they kind of set up camp and they have to decide on a different path.
Yeah,
you know, and so
we get picked up, feeling very defeated already. You know, we just started on this journey and already it feels like our paths are very limited. Right.
Yeah.
I don't know if they.
I'm sure they really aren't they? Because I mean. You know, it's like
they talk about the two options, and there's really not two options here.
Yeah,
they really have one choice.
Yeah, they have one choice.
You know,
yeah. You mean when we start this chapter?
Yes.
Going back and going forward.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And is going back really an option?
No, it's to admit failure.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And so they kind of play it up as well. We could do this. We could go back to Rivendell, or we could continue on in this place that I thought maybe we'd have to go anyway. Gandalf kind of saying, but really, it's like going back ain't a choice, man.
No, it's not.
That's defeat. That is raising the white flag.
Yeah, yeah. You know, one of the things I love about this, it just hit me, is that when Lane and I do this, we don't talk about the chapter before with each other at all.
No.
So it's always kind of neat.
It's invigorating, isn't it?
I mean, yeah, it's great. That's why I love it. So and then you want to summarize just real quick this chapter? I mean,
So you know, there's a short council, and Gandalf pretty much says, "Hey." To the Fellowship, we got to go through the mines of Moria.
Yeah.
So they have some trouble finding the gates of Moria. The geography has changed a little bit since Gandalf has been there last.
Good call.
But eventually they do find it, only to be stumped again. It seems like this chapter they go, they're stumped.
That's right.
They go, they're stumped. And really, who we see developing here as a character is Gandalf.
Mm-hmm.
We're seeing a challenge overcome.
About time.
Challenge overcome. He's back finally.
But
he's
this
a wandering
is,
wizard.
But as we know, this is where you need that.
This is his
time.
His great trials.
This is his moment.
Right, exactly. Okay. So and it's exciting because we know what's coming. If you've seen the film and you know, rereading the book, we know what's ahead. But this is just this building up to this of, you know, and it's Gandalf. It's not on Frodo. It's not on Aragorn. Aragorn has to sit back and say, you know, hey, it's all right. This guy knows what he's doing.
Yeah.
He's Gandalf.
Yep.
So anyway, they get to the gate. Get in the nick of time, only to evade a strange presence in the water. In the films, it's called the Watcher. In this chapter, it's just, I don't know what it was. Gandalf didn't even know. So they make their way into the mines. And again, it's this labyrinth. You know, do we go up? Do we go down? Do we go straight ahead?
Yep.
But Gandalf is able to pull from memory and also use his senses to get them in the right direction.
Yep. Yep.
Really cool development here for Gimli in this chapter as well, as Gimli is, you know, these are his people.
It's kind of neat you have him come forward, right?
He
Aragorn
even talks
last
about
chapter.
Physically, he steps up. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah.
It was Aragorn before, and now it's Gimli up to the forefront.
Right. And later on, we'll have the same thing, actually. So someone else will step forward and so on.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, it's a good idea to think about that. Great point. And then we end up in a very kind of sad state of realizing that, you know, we had hoped. Beyond hope, maybe that we would find some dwarves in Moria, but at the end of the chapter, we realize that that will not be, or we, I guess
case.
It's kind of detailed in the next chapter, but that won't be so.
Yep.
Yeah.
So. Okay. All right. So let's dive into it. We've actually broken it down into, what, 10 or 11?
Because you're right. It is a long chapter.
It's a long chapter.
It's easy to read, though, isn't it?
Yeah.
It doesn't
yeah.
feel like a longer chapter.
No. And that's why we decided to do it all in one take here, one episode. But there's quite a bit. So as you mentioned, we're going to start with so we'll go over the council session, wolf attack. We've got finding the gate, speak, friend, and enter.
Yeah.
The watcher attack, into Moria. We say Gollum's footsteps.
Right.
You know, are they?
Are they?
A place of no memory. What's that hall called?
Dwerodelf. Dwerodelf.
Dwerodelf. Yeah. Cool.
I think.
Yeah.
I'm going based on hearing Gandalf in the films.
Okay, good.
The Great Whelm. Whelm? The Great Realm of Dwerodelf.
Okay.
You know, that British accent. Yes. Just...
Gimli gives us a little history, and then Balin's tomb.
Yeah.
Okay. So back to the this little council session that they have. It's pretty quick.
It is.
Just kind of go back and forth and talk about that. As you already said, we need to pick a different path.
Right.
We can't go back. Frodo. Actually, the hobbits look kind of.
They're excited at the thought of going back, right?
Right. They're like, what? Their ears perk up. Like, we're going back? What?
Yeah.
Frodo knows in his heart that they can't do that. It would mean defeat.
Yep.
So to go forward would be a way that, if Strider, Aragorn, is not interested in this way, it seems ominous. Mm-hmm. You know, the hobbits have got to be shaken.
Yeah.
You know, a little bit. Like, where are we heading?
Yeah. Here?
These guys are nervous about this.
Yeah, they are. Sam even talks about his heart being in his toes, I think, coming up here. He and Pippin especially are very, very worried about journeying into the Dark of Moria. Because it says, even to the hobbits, it was a legend of vague fear.
Yeah.
The Mines of Moria.
Well, okay. The Mines of Moria, you're right. Yeah. And so right before that, Mary actually says, if it's a worse road than the Redhorn Gate, then it must be evil indeed.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, if it's worse than what we've just been through,
Are
you kidding me? Because Gandalf talks about, doesn't he say, it's, he says, from the very beginning, I thought, when first considered this journey that we should try this way, but it's not pleasant.
Right.
And I have not spoken of it to the company before, except for Aragorn. That's what this debate was about.
Yeah.
Do we take the Redhorn Pass or the gate, the Pass of Caradhras, or do we, go through Moria? And that's what they were going back and forth about. Gandalf wanting to go through Moria, Aragorn being reluctant and wanting to try that mountain pass.
And another option is brought up by Boromir, which is just to go south, straight south.
Right.
Instead of cutting across the mountain path and going under the mountains.
Yes.
They said they couldn't go over, they couldn't go through, so they want to go under. He's like, why go, why not just go straight down south and around?
Yep. He says, Gap Rohan.
Yeah.
And then he also says, cross the Isen into Langstrand and Lebanon.
Right.
Right. Yeah. And what does Gandalf say? He has a great point there.
Yeah. Things have changed.
Yeah.
Since you came north.
Right. And he even says, when you travel that road coming to Rivendell, you were one southern.
That's right. Yep.
What does he say? Stranger or mm-hmm. Traveler.
Just one person.
Right. Yeah. So you weren't of concern. But now he says, the enemy, Sauron, is watching those ways very carefully. For any kind of movement. And he even says, to take that really far southern pass, he said it would be harborless, and there wouldn't be anything there.
Well, Boromir even wants him to possibly cut through, as you said, across Rohan and closer to the sea.
Yeah.
And come down by the sea.
Yeah.
And land that, as you said, that was possibly uninhabited.
Right.
And barren, but right. they talk that...
Gandalf says that there would be no refuge there.
Yeah.
As well as there being no place to stay along the way, no, I guess, group of people that could aid them.
Yep.
It'd also be open
to attack,
get screwed. Yeah.
And maybe they don't know, what would be in that land.
Right.
Perhaps
sure.
It's been occupied by the enemy and things.
Exactly.
I don't know.
Yeah.
But
not a sure thing.
Well, and they're open to the spies, and so as soon as they're spied there, they're vulnerable. They're out in the open. Yep. Can they get help from Rohan? They don't even know that.
They don't
know yet. So.
So again, all these other options that people are bringing up, they're just being shut down as they're not really realistic. They're not the wisest choice. And so Gandalf is kind of guiding them through this through his thinking.
Yeah,
they're bringing up these questions like, well, what if we take this? What if we do this? And he's like,
I've already thought about this, guys.
Right. I've been
that's sorry, but I'm
talking about it. Right.
All right.
Yeah. So,
well, he makes a real good point here with Boromir about. They're talking about just how evil Moria is, and he almost compares it to Mordor.
Yeah,
and
Moria is black,
right?
Yeah,
and Gandalf kind of is offended by that.
Yeah, yep.
He's like, hold on a second. I've actually been, in in the dungeons of Dol Guldur.
Right.
Right, which is the lesser fortress.
And he says, I'm the only one amongst us who's you know, experienced that.
Right.
And I've been to Moria, so I can compare both.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So it's cool to see Gandalf kind of... I think a lot of times we see Gandalf compromising and you know, I mean, sort of being like that... what's it called? Mediator, in a way. And here he's kind of saying, like, listen, guys. I know what I'm talking about. I'm Gandalf.
Yeah.
I've been here. I've done this. Just, you really got to trust me on this point.
Right. Well, yeah. And actually, this is where you get some of that connection to what we see that Peter Jackson did in The Hobbit.
Yes.
Which is bringing in Dol Guldur and, you know, the necromancer and all that good stuff. And who's he run across there in the prison, in the dungeons he runs across? Thrain?
Yeah.
That he runs across there?
Yeah.
You've got
Thrain and Thorin.
Thorin, yeah. So it's, yeah. I think he runs across...
Thorin's dad. Is that Thorin's who that dad. Is?
Yeah, his father.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Ends up getting the key and stuff. Yeah.
My Hobbit knowledge is a little fuzzy there, but yeah.
No, I'm pretty sure that's who it is. And
yeah.
And so, you know, anyways, just kind of interesting connection, you know.
It's right
It happens
there.
In The Lord of the Rings. I've had other friends ask me, you know, where was any of that in The Hobbit? And
right.
It's like, actually, they pulled it from, you know, some of the histories.
Gandalf is gone. Yeah.
Yes. And they made connections here through Lord of
the Rings. You got it. As it was, I sought there long for Thrain, son of Thror, after he was lost. Yep. I passed through and I came out again alive. And then we also get this nugget. I had totally forgotten about this. Aragorn says, I too once passed the Dimmerol Gate.
Yeah. Yeah. And I thought about the show when I
did too.
When I read
well, every
this.
Time we hear history of Aragorn now, I'm like, yep, bingo.
There
you go. That's an episode. That's a two-parter. But though I also came out again, the memory is very evil, and I do not wish to enter Moria a second time.
Yeah.
What happened there? What are the details? And we see now why maybe, you know, Gandalf didn't sound like it was such a hard time for him going through Moria. It wasn't as big of a deal.
Yeah.
Aragorn, it was. So you're starting to see the logic between Aragorn saying, don't want to go that way.
Well, and look how powerful
saying, yeah, sure.
Gandalf is.
Yeah.
Not a big deal. And then you've got Aragorn, pretty boss, but not as powerful as Gandalf
sure.
saying,
different way.
It's a little harder.
Yeah.
Can you imagine if... someone else lesser than Aragorn tried to travel through.
Sure.
So you see you go with this hierarchy, you kind of, you move down, it's like, this might not be good for the hobbits or, right. you know, for, you know, lesser men.
Right.
So,
and I guess too, it's also this thing, you know, we're getting this, this message that this is a quest for men. This is a chance for men to take back Middle Earth.
Yeah.
And what we're, and Aragorn has kind of been a huge leader so far.
Yeah.
And this is a chance for us to really realize, you know, if Aragorn is the king of men, right?
Yeah, yeah.
To see Gandalf, you know, for him to yield to Gandalf is a big deal. And it's just another chance, like we said, how this chapter just illuminates Gandalf. It's another chance for us to see, wow, Gandalf is this. I mean, we knew he was before, but I mean, check this out. It's incredible.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. One more quick little nugget that I thought, because I always like to make the connections to The Hobbit's my favorite.
Yeah.
So I love it. But the reference to the Battle of Five Armies.
Yeah.
Was cool, I thought, actually. It, because they talk about, is there hope?
Yeah.
You know, Gandalf says, I wouldn't take us in here if I didn't think there was any hope.
Mm-hmm.
If he thought that it was completely infested, you know, with orcs and what have you in here, and like active like it was back before the battle of the five armies, right?
Yeah.
He knows that since that battle, they've been scattered.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they are maybe possibly massing elsewhere, but right now... they're scattered, and then and it seems like, you know, it should be. There is hope in secrecy and this huge city, you know, of Moria under the mountain. We can maybe get through. So
interesting here though that so you're talking about how Gandalf is making a point of kind of disbanding those fears, like, you know, the orcs might not be as populated. You know, there may yet be dwarves alive there. Balin, you know, went to seek a way to reclaim Moria. And it's Aragorn who steps here and says, you know, I will, we have, you know, Gimli saying, I'll go. Aragorn says, I will. He says it heavily. And he says, you know, you followed my lead almost to disaster in the snow and have said no word of blame. I will follow your lead now if this last warning does not move you. He says, it is not of the ring, nor of us others that I am thinking now, but of you, Gandalf. And I say to you, if you pass the doors of Moria, beware.
Man.
So a little vision there.
Here's the thing. I actually truly believe though they had a conversation back in Rivendell, and Aragorn's first when his last you know pass through of Moria, he knows what's possibly there or what is there, and he full out warns Gandalf before he goes, and Gandalf says, "Got it."
Yeah,
It's in the back.
Yep.
Don't worry about it.
And this
don't worry about me.
Right. Right. And you know, is this foresight of Aragorn knowing, you know, that Gandalf, you've got a challenge to face yet, and Gandalf being aware of that too, but just saying, I'm not afraid of this other stuff. The ring doesn't concern me. You know, the powers, you know, the orcs and all this stuff, it doesn't bother me. It's not our safety I'm worried about. It's you, man.
Right. And don't you feel like, I mean, because right here, he's not telling the rest of the company what may be, because they may not come across it. There's no need.
Right.
But he did have a conversation prior with Gandalf.
Yeah.
I think it's pretty clear.
Yeah.
So, about this. So, all right, let's see.
Wow.
Now, that kind of ends the little council there, because all of a sudden the wind starts to howl.
Man. Some howling in the wind.
Some howling in the wind.
The wind howls, or the howling of, there's howling in the wind.
Something right? like that. So so we have wolves, right?
Yeah.
You know, the wargs have come west of the mountains.
Yeah.
And they jump up and they're, it's time to get the heck out of there.
Yeah.
Get a move on. I think they were going to rest.
They were. They had planned on it. They were just settling down. They were going to rest there. And then, you know, they have some commentary here. They're like, what do they say? Some of these lines are hilarious, dude. They're talking about how they're, you know, like 15, 20 miles away, you know, so they can't just hurry up and get to where they're going. Boromir says, you know, then let us start as soon as there's light tomorrow if we can. The wolf that one hears is worse than the orc that one fears. Mm-hmm. And then you've got Aragorn coming back with another one-liner. You got that?
Yeah, true. He says, but where the warg howls, there also the orc prowls.
Sounds like a podcast.
Yeah.
A couple podcast names almost. I mean, it does, I don't know,
actually.
But
those are actually pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's almost like that was like a saying, you know, for them.
Right.
It might've been a saying around that time.
It may have been. So yeah. So anyway, there's this new threat that's kind of surprised them and taken them off guard here.
That
howling is kind of unsettling.
It's freeze.
Wow.
You hear it? I do.
Frightening.
That is frightening. Oh my God, dude. That's a good one.
I mean, can you imagine? They just got out of a, you know, they were driven away,
yeah,
and now they're being hunted.
Well, and don't they talk at times? I know they did in the last chapter about how quiet things were.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
And so, you know, it
almost
was actually
too quiet.
Too quiet. It was eerie. Their laughter and stuff was kind of a problem.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's interesting. So for their, let's see.
There are just a lot of cool lines there.
Pippin has some good lines, yeah.
Wish I would have taken Elrond's advice. I am no good after all. There is not enough of the breed of Bandabris. The bull roarer in me, these howls freeze my blood. I don't even remember feeling so wretched. Don't ever remember.
Right.
And then Sam says, my heart's right down on my toes, but we aren't Etten yet, and there are some stout folk here with us. Whatever may be in store for old Gandalf, I'll wager it isn't a wolf's belly.
Right, I thought that was kind of neat. Yeah. He's not going to, you know, the wolf's not going to put him down.
Again, we're building Gandalf up here.
Yeah.
It's just like, this is going to be, you know, treacherous, but we'll be okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. So they kind of climb on top of this hill. Right, Ez?
Right, yeah, they do.
They say, you know, to survive this night, we got to take a defensive point. So they go up on this hill.
They get a little fire going.
Yep, and there's some scrub and some trees and also some boulders that kind of encircle it. So there's some defense there as well. Yeah, they light a fire. They're like, you know, people are going to know we're here anyway. So,
yeah.
You know, we're being hunted by wolves, so we'll risk the fire for sure.
Right, right.
Yeah. And then... Let me see here.
Oh, actually, so at one point, Gandalf kind of stands up. He strides forward, holding his staff aloft. He says, listen, Hound of Sauron, he cried. Gandalf is here. Fly, if you value your foul skin. So that more of building him up, right?
Yeah.
I will shrivel you from tail to snout
if
you come within this ring.
Yeah, because they start seeing these peering eyes.
Yeah.
And then there's one dark wolf shape that comes up and halts, kind of like challenging. Right?
Yeah.
And then that's where Gandalf comes up and says, it's go time.
Yeah.
And then this wolf snarls and comes right at him. And who has the blow that kills him? That's right. Little arrow twangs out.
Don't they call that wolf like a chieftain?
Yeah, he stood there like a chief, or a leader of these wolves, you know, a great beast.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Yep. Okay. So that's a little scary, you know, scene there. The hobbits have to get their swords out, you know,
yeah.
kind of standing all back to back and stuff.
And Tolkien, this is something I didn't remember necessarily. Tolkien does such a good job of writing like battle, battle narrative like this. It is so interesting.
Yes.
So cool. Like you really, you can see this play out, and it fits perfectly with how Peter Jackson, I mean, I would have loved to have seen this. Mm-hmm. This would have been amazing.
This is cool.
Yeah.
And again, it goes back. So after Legolas lets his arrow fly,
yeah.
Silence.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So, it's kind of their fears are the eyes disappear. They're extinguished.
Yeah.
And they maybe think that they've sort of dodged the bullet there.
Yeah. Yeah. So,
right.
The night was old. Yeah, and the westward waning moon was setting, gleaming fitfully through the breaking clouds. Suddenly, Frodo started from sleep, so they try to get a little bit of sleep, right?
Yeah.
Without warning, a storm of howls broke out, fierce and wild about all the camp. So that happens again?
Yeah.
Yeah, so they come back again.
Yeah, they come back, yep. Okay. Great host of wargs had gathered silently and was attacking. And this is where Gandalf says, throw more fuel on the fire. Get out your blades.
Yeah, okay.
Stand there you go. Back to back. Let's do it, baby.
Right.
And they
right.
kind of have like this big battle with these wolves.
Yeah, yeah.
You've got Aragorn that puts his sword right through the throat of one huge leader.
There it is. The great wolf chieftain.
Yeah. There you go.
I thought that was the first one. Okay, that's the
yep.
that's the next attack.
And
where
then,
they
then Boromir, I just love how he writes this. With a great sweep, Boromir hewed the head off another. Just one sweep, man.
Right.
Beside them, Gimli stood with his stout legs apart, wielding his dwarf axe. The bow of Legolas was singing.
Yeah.
So this is an all out gory battle, man.
Right.
They're slaying wolves, and these guys are coming. And then, oh, this is amazing. Again, just elevating Gandalf. In the wavering, you read this next paragraph. You've got to.
Oh,
he's your man.
In the wavering firelight, Gandalf seems suddenly to grow. He rose up, a great menacing shape, like the monument of some ancient king of stone, set upon a hill. Stooping like a cloud, he lifted a burning branch and strode to meet the wolves. They gave back before him. High in the air, he tossed the blazing brand. It flared with a sudden white radiance like lightning, and his voice rolled like thunder.
Come on.
Yeah.
Come on. Does that paint a picture or what?
Yeah, actually, yeah, it does. Oh. I mean, it really does. It's his voice, yeah, rolling like thunder.
Yeah.
And just...
like he is. And Gandalf has so much of this, you know, this lightning, fire, flame of Udun stuff, you know, right? This is one of his powers.
Yeah.
And then he sets fire to these trees.
Right, yeah.
And it goes from tree to tree, that those scrubby trees that are on that mm-hmm. on that hill, and it just lights it up. You know, there's light everywhere. Swords and knives of the defenders shone and flickered. The last arrow of Legolas kindled in the air as it flew and plunged, burning into the heart of a great... There you go, the great wolf chieftain.
Yeah.
All the others fled.
Yeah, can you imagine
that? What a climax, man.
Yeah, all of that. I mean, that... There you go. You get some of his... A glimpse of his power.
Yes.
Right? And I think just a glimpse.
Yes.
Obviously. We're just dealing with wolves.
Just
here.
A glimpse.
Yeah.
He's like, how much attention should I draw to myself?
Well, and that's what he did when he
I'm a badass.
Exactly. That's what he did when he was trying to, you know, push their way through the snow.
Yeah, with the fire.
Know, with,
right.
with
It's
with
reluctantly
melting.
Almost.
Yeah, and it's sort of like, how much here can I do? Because
it
does leave a mark when he uses his abilities.
Yeah, you he's know, on the radar then.
Can you imagine? I mean, anybody who's spying around the area or right. looking, like, well, they're already on to him right here, you know, in a sense, the
or even,
wolves.
Yeah, and even higher beings that can sense that from a distance.
Yeah,
sense
exactly.
that power being used.
Exactly.
You're right, yeah. Not even just, you know, like spies that are,
right.
you know, just looking
for
physical.
Because their greatest weapon is secrecy,
yeah.
you know, and
yeah.
so.
And Gandalf's always, you're right, conscious of that.
Yeah.
That's right. But man alive, dude. And so I have a question because I'm fuzzy on The Hobbit. I've never, here you go. Wow. Confession time.
You confess.
People
you
are going to hate
it.
Me.
You already confessed it.
I said that already?
On the appendices.
On the appendices. Okay, so this is bringing the appendices to the podcast here, guys. I've never read The Hobbit all the way through.
It's crazy.
So when we do a reread after this,
man.
It actually won't be... it'll be a reread for most of it.
You've
for
read
me.
A lot of it.
A lot of it, but I've never gotten all the way through, ashamedly.
That's crazy.
It's just because I love Lord of the Rings so much, and it's written very differently.
Yeah,
it
they
is.
Are. Yeah.
But this is where I'm fuzzy. So when they encounter the wolves... after the Goblin King and the Misty Mountains, is there all this fire element and all this battle and stuff that goes on, or is it in the books?
Hmm. You mean like so? Right after they get outside of they come out after the goblins.
Is there like a great fire and all this stuff burning the trees? Because here's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking Peter Jackson missed out on this opportunity for The Lord of the Rings, just couldn't fit it in.
Mm-hmm.
This scene reminds me a lot of
The
Hobbit
right.
film.
You're right.
The wolves attacking, they're on kind of a cliffside on a hill, the trees are lit on fire, big battle climax.
I'm trying to think if that. I feel like more of what happened that was flashy happened inside of the.
That's what of the mountain.
But I.
That's what I had thought. They climbed the trees, and the eagle saved them up in the trees. They weren't like dangling on the edge in a big fire, was there?
I don't remember a fire.
Okay.
I don't remember. But
so I'm thinking maybe this is him incorporating a little bit of that, because Gandalf is the one who started those fires. He took those in the Hobbit film. He took those pine cones, set them on fire, and they started throwing them. Remember, the dwarves were throwing them at the wargs, and then those bounced off and caught the trees on fire, and it's very dramatic. And okay. that's the visual I got with this. Is it's like a combination of what we saw in that film and what we're reading on the page. It's just this big fire that sort of. Is amazing visually to imagine, but also it's just this way of keeping those wolves off so that they can fight them more effectively as they're on top of this mountain.
Yeah, and what's interesting, because you follow, remember how they get split?
Yeah.
Bilbo actually goes, that's when he gets the ring, and he's actually invisible. So,
oh yeah.
When he comes back to them, I can't remember, but they're deciding whether to go on without him or not.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's when he's actually able to kind of catch up with them. And
so someone check me on that. I just can't, I don't know if that's... Anyway, I kept thinking about that scene in The Hobbit because it was in the film, it was very similar to, you know, what we were doing here.
Yeah, no, great question, man. Honestly, I'll have to look it up more.
Sort of an obscure thing, a little detail, but, you know, whatever. It was cool to imagine here. I love what Sam says. He goes, what did I tell you, Mr. Pippin? Said Sam, sheathing his sword. Wolves won't get him. That was an eye opener, no mistake. Nearly singed the hair off my head. So, just an incredible little battle that we have heading into, searching for the gate, the Dimmerill Gate.
Yeah, I think that's what we're going to move into next, right? So,
yeah,
we have to find those landmarks that Gandalf thought, would kind of give or lead him to the gate.
Yes,
he actually takes them in a way in which they cut off several miles off their trip, don't they?
Yeah, that's right. Yep.
I can't see that exactly, but yeah, suddenly after the wolves have died away, do they camp there, right? Because when the full light of morning came and there was no more signs of the wolves, that's when they move on, right? That's when they
This kind of happened as night was ending.
Yeah.
Yeah, so they had stayed there that night uneasily. Morning's starting to break, this battle happens, and then...
And they can get there in about a day because Gandalf says we must reach the doors before sunset.
Right, right.
So they have, it's dawn and they have, till sunset to kind of get there. So
yeah, yeah. And it doesn't go as quickly as he had hoped, right? And eventually, what they say, there's a line here, quickly it was like noon and they still hadn't really, they were still wandering.
Yeah, they were still wandering.
They were looking for this river.
Yeah.
Right? They were looking for the river, the Saranen, that led right along the gate.
Yeah.
And they can't find it.
Yep.
And at one point you have... hold on a second here. I'm sorry. Okay. He says, we must reach the doors before sunset, or I fear we shall not reach them at all. It is not far, but our path may be winding, for here Aragorn cannot guide us, which is another unsettling thought. And another way that we're seeing, hey, this is a Gandalf chapter.
Yeah.
Right. Yep, Aragorn's not any use to us. He has seldom walked in this country, and only once have I been under the west wall of Moria, and that was long ago. And they're kind of up on this perch. They're up on a hillside, and it's he and Gimli that are up there.
Yep.
And they say there it lies. He said, pointing away southwards to where the mountains fell. Oh, I'm sorry. No, they're not on the hill yet. But they see where the walls are.
Yeah.
And they know that they've got to get over that way,
but they get to the hill though, and that's when they're
okay.
Actually, like they're looking for. You're right. They talk about the stream, and as they go towards it, it says that either Gandalf is astray, or the land has changed,
right?
And what they're looking for, we find out later that
that's right.
That it's dammed up,
right? Yeah, it's been damned.
That's why they weren't able to find it. So they're looking for more clues here. Okay, so eventually Gandalf says, here it is at last. This is where the stream ran.
Yeah.
They call it the gate stream, right?
Yes.
But what has happened to the water, I cannot guess.
Yeah.
It used to be swift and noisy.
Right.
So come on, we have to hurry. Let's go.
And it was Gimli who spotted it from the knoll. That's right.
There you go.
And Gandalf comes up by his side and says, yep, there it is. Okay. So. They're tired, obviously, at this point. They're
worn out. Yeah. I think too, as they get closer, the idea that things have changed and they're not the same is an indication that something's not good about this, right. You know, that something like that would have dried up, you know, or what have you. So
yeah. Why did it change so drastically? Sure.
Yeah. Okay. Let's see. They make their way towards, well, the past, they're going along the drying up of the gate stream.
Yep.
Behind them, the sinking sun filled the cool western sky with glittering gold. Before them stretched a dark, still lake. Neither sky nor sunset was reflected on its sullen surface. And that's where they find out that it had been dammed up. And they actually, it lies between, the lake lies between them and the door.
Yeah.
Doesn't it? Because they... Yeah.
Getting there is a struggle.
Yeah.
Yeah, having to find that path. And what had actually, they also had the stair falls before that. Remember the trickling over that? It had once been a great waterfall where the river had come off. And so they had to climb up there and then found the lake. And then you're right, saw that, wow, this is, it was wide and far. It had been dammed up so much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
But they can see, you're right, they can see the walls in the distance. And there the gate once upon a time, the elven door at the end of the road from Holland by which we have come.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But this way is blocked. None of the company, I guess, will wish to swim this gloomy water at the end of the day. It has an unwholesome look. So, I mean, you're right. It was such a barrier that Gandalf would have, you know, that was an option, an unsavory option. But hey, does anyone want to swim this to get to where we need to go?
Yeah. Well, and actually at that point, like as you said, they don't want to swim it, and they do see the elven door, right, at the end of the road from Holland by which they had come. And it's neat because this is a, at one point in time, back in Durin's day, Moria and the elves of Holland would trade.
Yeah.
You know, and you could actually come
in. Happier times.
Yeah, you could come in and out this way.
It says later that the door was often left open.
Right, exactly.
It wasn't even shut.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So they're looking for a door that, that they can, they know they're going to have to use some, well, actually, the hobbits don't realize, I'm sorry.
They don't even know where the door is.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. They see the two trees first. I should mention that, right? The two trees that indicate where it's at as well.
Yeah.
And then as they get closer, they do work their way around
the
lake. They have to go, and Bill's with them still, but they do kind of mention here.
Yeah, Gandalf and Frodo have that conversation that Bill's
not going to be able to continue with them.
It's going to be pretty rough going even for old Bill. And we find out that Gandalf would have been against, you know, he was against taking him in the first place because he knew what was going to, you know, what they were going to have to, the terrain they're going to have to go over. And then especially, you know, the fact that Sam was so fond of it.
Well, and actually, you're right. They actually bring Bill and they pack more because they were going to take Aragorn's path. And that's if right. that would have worked, it would have been okay.
Right.
But in the back of his mind, he kind of knows, I don't think it's going to work.
Yeah.
And so, you know, but so let's see. They kind of hurry forward. They still had like a mile or two before they could reach the point on the far shore that Gandalf was making for. And then they were going to find the doors.
The light's starting to fail at this point. So it's the end of the day. That setback of them not being able to find the river really did kind of hurt them in a way.
Yeah.
Or at least delayed their plans. They wanted to get there quicker.
Yeah.
So but really, I guess it aids them, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does.
Because the way they can see the door.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so we'll talk about the next two kind of points here, the Speak Friend and Enter and the Watcher attack together.
Yes.
Because, you know, basically...
They happen at the same time.
As Frodo's kind of going along there, his foot kind of dips into the lake and the water.
Yeah.
And he feels this like real treacherous, like just eerie feeling. Yeah. He's not worried about getting beyond the... Moria is not what's upsetting him.
No.
You know,
sliding in greasy stones is talking about in that nasty water.
Yeah, yeah.
Talking about where they crossed the creek.
Oh yeah,
yeah. So their way was barred by that creek, and they crossed through it. Green and stagnant water. So just we're getting a picture. It's not definitely not something you would have wanted to swim in. Like that was clearly a joke.
Yeah.
Pretty nasty water.
Well, and they hear that soft little like
soft sound, a swish followed by a plop.
Yeah.
As if a fish, go ahead and read it. Yeah, it's good
just
stuff.
Just as if a fish had disturbed the still surface of the water. Turning quickly, they saw ripples, black edged with shadow in the waning light.
Yikes.
And so that's pretty messed up. You know, that's kind of eerie. And it is, again, pretty silent.
Yeah.
Because then it says it goes back to silence.
That's right.
And that's not the only time that they're going to hear that. They're right. going to hear another, you know, sound there. But, you know, anyways, let's move on ahead here. Gandalf says that, well, we're here at last. Here the Elven Way from Holland ended. And he says, Holly was a token of the people of that land, as you had mentioned earlier, and they planted it here to mark the end of their domain. For the West Door was made chiefly for their use and their traffic with the lords of Moria.
Yeah.
Those were happier days, as you said. So, Gimli and Legolas go back and forth. I'll read Gimli, you read Legolas.
Yeah.
It was not the fault of the dwarves that the friendship waned.
I have not heard that it was the fault of the elves. Then Gandalf says, yeah. As so often is true.
Yeah, I've heard both.
Right. Right. And he asks them, he begs them actually, like, you know, I need you both. Let's kindle a friendship here.
Yeah.
And kind of alluding to that history of let's bring back what there once was. Dude, and so because I was curious, I was like, Holland, what is its significance? I did a little bit of research there.
Yeah.
So it was ruled by Celebrimbor, the forger of the rings.
Yeah.
So very interesting how that area even ties into their quest and what's going on right now.
Didn't they say he made the marks on the door here too?
Yes, that's coming up as well. Okay. That's right. So, and also rulers of Holland were Celeborn and Galadriel. Wow. Isn't that crazy? Yeah, really? My mind was blown because I hadn't done this research, didn't know it before. So it was ruled by Celebrimbor, Celeborn and Galadriel. The elves actually befriended in this area. They befriended Annatar. Who, you know, and created the rings of power for him. He was called, they called him the Lord of Gifts. Gifts, excuse me, not GIFs, gifts.
Wow.
And they tried to save the rings. There was some conflict there, to be brief. And they managed to say, that's how they managed to save the three elven rings.
Yeah, yeah.
Sauron came back with a vengeance, pretty much laid out and laid waste to Holland. And then those elves actually fled. So that's where they fled to Lindon.
Yeah.
They fled to Lothlorien. And then they fled to Imladris.
Yeah, okay.
So that's how those kingdoms were set up as well, those realms for the elves. And it actually talks about, dude, I didn't know this, the demise of Celebrimbor. Sauron pretty much like tortured him for 2 years to tell him where the other rings were. And he told him all except for the three elven rings. And wow. So that's how Sauron was able to control the other ones.
Holy smokes. The
rings of men, especially, it said. You know, obviously the ring
yeah,
rings.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
And then it talked about when Celebrimbor, after Celebrimbor, he was tortured for like 2 years and eventually he died. Mm-hmm. Sauron put him up on like a big stick as like a almost like a pennant or a flag and carried his dead body around.
Holy smokes.
Can you imagine that? Like as like a...
holy smokes.
A warning of like this is what happens when you cross.
Yeah, that just makes you hate Sauron that much.
Yeah. More, so it's just, it's very interesting that this area they've just come through and the connection between these dwarves of old and the elves is tied right into
That's a really cool connection.
The evil they're trying to defeat right now.
Yeah. Yeah.
So crazy. And it's just another way that Tolkien intentionally layered all this stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
In a way that... You know, it. If you get curious with it, which I'm starting to become, you always have been, you can really find, you can just make the stories even deeper that way.
Yeah.
So, really cool.
That's why I am glad that we're going to dive just head first into all the histories.
Yeah.
Because it's...
Hobbit's Guide, baby.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
So cool.
Cool stuff. Okay, sorry about
that. Glad you did that.
No. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. So, as they get closer to the door, Gimli's, you know, tapping around the stone here and there with his axe. Legolas was pressed up against the rock as if he's listening.
Yep.
And then Mary says, well, here we are and all ready, right? But where are the doors? I can't see any sign of them. And that's when we learn that the dwarves made them, they're invisible.
Yep.
You know? Only their own masters. Well, actually, he says they're invisible and their own masters cannot find them or open them if their secret is forgotten.
How cool is that?
Yeah, and so they talk for a little bit about how you could use a word to get through.
Uh-huh.
You could use, you know, a key.
Key. Yeah. Perhaps. Gandalf talks about the different dwarven doors.
Yeah.
Yeah. And how this one wasn't made in secret, so there's going to be a way that they can find it.
Yeah.
And then right between the shadow. So they find these trees, right? And right between the shadow, there was a smooth place. And over this, Gandalf passed his hands to and fro, muttering words under his breath. Then he stepped back. The moon now shone upon the gray face of the rock, but they could see nothing else for a while. Then slowly on the surface, where the wizard's hand had passed, faint lines appeared, like slender veins of silver running in the stone. At first, they were no more than pale gossamer threads, so fine that they only twinkled fitfully where the moon caught them. But steadily, they grew broader and clearer until their design could be guessed.
Yeah.
So
that's
cool.
Pretty neat. Yeah.
So cool.
And that's where he's going to focus most of his attention. Although you get to see the inscription, you know, as it grows, right?
Yeah.
So
they see the emblems of Durin. Legolas says, you know, there's the tree of the high elves. So again, just this idea of dwarven and elvish symbols.
Mm-hmm.
Elvish runes on a dwarven door. You see that history of friendship. And I guess also as it's kind of foreshadowing, or not foreshadowing, but leading up, building up to this friendship between Legolas and Gimli.
Yeah, it is.
Right? There's this conflict between them, and then we're seeing also, hey, this was how it used to be.
Yeah, you're right.
Gandalf's pleading with them. They're in this fellowship together, and this is a friendship that's going to be forged
through
this journey.
Yeah, for sure.
I think it's really cool because you always try to catch little stuff that's in the film, right, that's also in the books.
Yeah.
And then I'll stop bogging us down.
No, you're
but
fine.
Gandalf says, they are wrought of Ithildin. And you hear him say this in the movies. He's kind of looking at the doors, and he goes, Ithildin. And then he looks up, and he says, made to mirror only starlight and moonlight. So that part makes it into the film, which is really, really cool.
That is cool, yeah.
So he says, you know, it sleeps until it is touched by one who speaks words now long forgotten in Middle-earth.
Yeah.
So going to be a challenge there to find those words.
Right, yeah. He had to think long and hard on that, right?
Yeah, yep.
In Frodo's versed in the Elvish tongue and stuff. So, you know, he's wondering, why can't I read this?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And he kind of talks about this was sort of that West, you know, Elvish tongue.
Yeah.
Right.
And everyone who speaks, it's gone now.
Right.
Yeah. So, yeah. Like a dead language, which also is kind of cool. Another sidebar is that Tolkien was obsessed with these languages that were kind of disappearing. And one of his great, sadnesses was that, you know, as globalization kind of began and took off, you know, as we're more and more connected, the need to communicate within the same language. And there are all these languages that have actually died.
Yeah.
And that was something that he obviously really mourned and tried to fight against, even in creating his own languages. Right.
Mm-hmm.
He talks about, like, he was obsessed with this Finnish language you know, less and less people were speaking. And it was the language used for the tale, the Kalevala. Which is also influenced this story as well. It was a huge like source of inspiration for him too. So kind of interesting too how he just little side note there. He's talking about how some languages that used to be spoken and well known nobody knows.
Right.
Even Gandalf is struggling.
That's
right?
Interesting.
Which
is
crazy.
Well, because Boromir to kind of press on.
Yeah, get us
here,
up. Yep.
Is that you know he kind of says do you know the word? They talk about there will be a word, based upon. You know, what they had read above, which was, you know, speak, friend,
password,
and enter.
Yeah.
You know, and so they thought, oh, cool, it's just a word. We have to figure out what the password is. Gimli says, you know, it would have been given to, you know, those people at that time, and they knew the word, speak it, and you can enter.
Mm-hmm.
We find out it's much simpler than that.
Yeah.
But you know,
Boromir's
kind of like, what the heck? wait. So you said you went to Moria, you know, and Gandalf has to explain.
Set him straight.
He's like, hold on a second.
Maybe you didn't hear my story, is what he says, pretty much.
Yeah. So, actually, let's see here. Boromir says he's kind of accusing him. Then what was the use of bringing us to this accursed spot?
Yeah.
You told us that you had once passed through the mines. How could that be if you did not know how to enter? So, to answer his first question, you know, is that I do not know the word yet. So, yet being key. But we shall soon see. And he added, with a glint in his eyes, under his bristling brow, you may ask what is the use of my deeds when they are proved useless. As for your other question, do you doubt my tale or have you no wits left? I did not enter this way. I came from the east. And so he's just kind of explaining that he actually explains that the doors from the inside, you had to press them out, right?
Yeah.
So, but to come in from this way.
So he's had no use. He's had no, there was no opportunity for him to come in this way. So why would he know it?
Yeah.
You know, kind of defended himself there a little bit.
Yep, for sure. So he goes up and he gives it his best. We'll just say that. Gandalf, you know, thinks and goes through a bunch of different things. You know, gives it a go and it doesn't work.
Dude, I love this because I used to, when I was a kid, before I even read the books, I would try to guess what the heck he was saying. Anon not Helen. Edro hi amen. Like Ian McKellen does such
a good job of that.
Well it's just mimicry because I know you hear him and then he says Fenis Nogorthim Lasto Beth Laman. And you know, in a commanding voice and nothing happens.
Well then he eventually gets real, you know, upset. Pissed and you know, raises his hands and tries to command that it open and doesn't work.
Nothing happens.
But you
threw
know
threw a staff on the ground, man.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, he's real upset. So let's see. At one point, Boromir throws a stone in the
into the
pool.
Yeah,
let me see real quick. Is that what he did?
Yeah, he did.
And
then Frodo. So it's so different from the movies, right? In the movies, you got Merry and Pippin throwing stones to kill time, and Aragorn says, "Do not disturb the water."
Well, and so think about this. So it's sort of a Pippin later will do the same thing.
Yeah.
But nobody really, you know, nobody really chastises Boromir here. But
well, Frodo.
Frodo does.
Yeah, Frodo's like, why are you doing that, dude?
Right, yeah. Don't mess with it, yeah.
Yeah, he says, you know, I hate this place. I'm afraid of a lot of things, but mostly this pool. Yeah. Don't disturb it if you don't have to. Which is interesting because we never really see Frodo talk to Boromir like that in the films. It's just kind of an interesting thing. Like, Frodo's like, stop. Don't do that. You know?
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah.
So he figures out that it's much simpler, right? You go ahead. What do you have there? So,
oh, Pippin's just...
why doesn't Gandalf do something quick?
Yeah. And they can also kind of hear the wolves again at this point.
Yeah, for sure.
And then they also see the ripples on the water, and they're growing closer and closer. Some are even lapping on the shore. So it's like...
And they're stuck here.
Yeah, they're up against a wall, rocking a hard place, essentially.
Yep.
And you know, they're starting to, the tension's starting to rise. And just as this stuff is closing in on them, light bulb goes off.
Yep, laughing. You know, I have it, he cried, of course. Absurdly simple, like most riddles, when you see the answer.
Yeah.
And he picks up his staff and he says, Balon, right? And he's able to, that's the word to get him in.
Yep.
He just speak friend, right? They just had to speak, they had to pick the, you know, what the Elvish word for friend.
Yeah, it's a joke, right? He says, quite simple, too simple for a learned lore master in these suspicious days. Those were happier times. So pretty much saying, I overthought it. It was easier than I realized.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so as the doors open, this is where we get the Watcher attack.
Yeah.
You know? And it actually really only tries to attack Frodo. I think had they already told Bill the Pony that he or Sam that he had to go?
Yes, they had told Sam that, you know, we're not gonna be able to take him, and Sam has this this freak out. He's like, no. Yeah. He's like, you can't take him. Essentially, I have it underlined because it's just, I find that relationship very touching. Yeah. I love that relationship that Sam regards him as a part of the fellowship. You know, I think to everyone, most everyone else, he's their pack pony.
Yeah.
He's carrying their stuff, whatever. He's like a cart, essentially. And to Sam, he's so much more.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think he sees him as, you know, they saw how he was treated or mistreated by Bill Ferny.
Yeah.
And he has some sort of relation to that. He feels a great pity for the beast. And then to see him progress and to see him grow stronger as they went on this journey. And, you know, maybe it's because he's leading them a lot of the time too, because Sam's always responsible for carrying everything, right? Mm-hmm. He is, and maybe that's the parallel or the connection between the two is Sam is kind of the pack pony of the hobbits. He's kind of the Bill of the hobbits.
Yeah.
You know, he says, and willingly, he says, Mr. Frodo, I'll, you know, way back when we first started this journey, Frodo was like, I'm sure you're carrying too much, Sam. We'll have to sort that out later so that you're not carrying more than you should.
Right.
And that's maybe there's a deeper connection there between them that way too. Yeah. But anyway, yeah, they say, you know, we're going to have to leave them. And
Gandalf whispers some words to him.
Yes, you know, he does. Stuff. Yeah. I call it the blessing of Bill.
Yeah.
And it's not the last time that we see him.
Yeah.
Which is a beautiful thing. he says, you know, can we just read it?
Read
is
it,
that
yeah.
okay?
Sure.
You know, I'm sorry. So I'm going to go back to where Sam, he says, but you can't leave poor old Bill behind in this forsaken place, Mr. Gandalf, cried Sam, angrily and distressed. I won't have it, and that's that. So really rising up here to Gandalf after he has come so far and all. I am sorry, Sam, said the wizard, but when the door opens, I do not think you'll be able to drag Bill inside into the long dark of Moria. You will have to choose between Bill and your master. He'd follow Mr. Frodo into Dragon's Den if I let him, protested Sam. It'd be nothing short of murder to turn him loose with all these wolves about. So another reason he doesn't want to let him go, obviously.
Yeah.
It will be short of a murder, I hope, said Gandalf. He laid his hand on the pony's head and spoke in a low voice. Go with words of guard and guiding on you. You are a wise beast and have learned much in Rivendell. Make your ways to places where you can find grass, and so come in time to Elrond's house or wherever you wish to go.
Yeah.
Just amazing.
Yeah.
And so Sam kind of realizes that here, obviously overcome with sadness, but Gandalf pretty much says, you know, you're going to have to make a decision between your pony and your master.
Yeah. Well, and that's what he does with the Watcher attack.
Right. So, yeah, fast forward to where this happens. And in a moment, I love how Tolkien just says, but at that moment, several things happened.
Yeah, several things happened.
Let's slow down time for a second, and I'm going to hash out everything that happens in the blink of an eye as Gandalf takes a step.
Yep, he takes a step. Frodo felt something seize him by the ankle.
Yep.
He fell with a cry. Bill the pony lets just off this wild dashes neigh. Out. Yeah, of fear.
Yep.
Takes off, or Sam leaped after him, but then hearing Frodo's cry, ran back, weeping and cursing, probably cursing himself, didn't know it was torn, right? He has to decide.
Yeah. Yeah.
And, you know, the others swung around and saw the water of the lake seething as if a host of snakes were swimming up from the southern end.
Man.
Yeah.
It was crazy.
Crazy little scene here. And then the tentacles out there, it crawled up around and was wrapping around Frodo's foot. And Sam, you know, on his knees, was now slashing at it with a knife.
So cool. They did such a good job of that in the film.
Yeah.
Very, amazing job.
So finally, it lets go of him, they're able to dart in. They're able to get in to Moria and things. So they collapse on the step in the black darkness, and the first thing that Sam says is, poor old Bill.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Yeah, he's worried about him.
Yeah.
And it's actually this watcher or this beast, whatever it is, that causes that collapse.
That's right.
Right, 20 more arms come out, or tentacles, whatever, and they're ripping and pulling, and that causes the collapse. Gandalf even says, you know, it's coming up here. He says, "I'm sorry for the trees were beautiful and it stood so long." You know,
yeah.
Talking about how their way back is barred now. They're not going back. They have one choice now.
Right.
And even though they're not thrilled about it.
Yeah,
they're in the dark here.
They're in the dark. They're in some caverns. Yeah.
Dripping, trickling.
The dripping.
Don't forget the dripping.
Don't forget the dripping.
That's for you, Nicole.
Oh man.
So they're in. Frodo says.
Well, he's talking about how he felt there was something horrible near.
Yeah, and it's interesting, you know, Gandalf.
They're reflecting on the Watcher.
Right.
Yeah.
Gandalf says, you know, he doesn't say it. He did not speak aloud his thought that whatever it was that dwelt in that lake, it had like you said, it had seized on Frodo first.
Yeah, yep.
So, yeah, knowing that power was him, the film creators theorized that even the Watcher desired the ring.
Sure. Why not?
I mean...
Yeah, for sure.
Crazy, right?
Well, they talk about the different things that dwelled down in in Moria, and it's hard to imagine all these different things that they could have dug up.
Yeah,
you know, it's as if it came out
yeah.
and is living in that lake.
You know what else? It might be kind of fun to dig up.
So, oh yeah,
I don't know. Yeah. Podcast name. We've got to start one eventually.
Dig up a podcast name. Yeah. Yeah, let's do it. Yeah.
Gotta get the name right, though. I don't know why you're looking at me.
Do we?
We gotta get the name right.
Let's see here. What do we want to call it? Live to See the Dawn.
Oh.
Live to See the Dawn.
I like it.
Podcast.
Kind of threatening.
Yeah.
What about Howling Winds podcast?
Howling Winds is actually
Howling
good.
Howling Wind. Maybe throwing some music there or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
You never know, Ez.
Right.
What else?
Let's see here. How about Between Wolves and a Wall?
Yeah. I like it. Yeah, you know what? They were writing podcast names for us, weren't they?
They were.
In this chapter. What about melon heads?
So ridiculous.
Because we're friends?
Right.
We're going to get there one of these days. Guys, stay tuned. We will start a Lord of the Rings podcast.
In the future.
Eventually. Maybe even turn into a book club and a beautiful, giant friendship. But
we promise
there's no way to tell. No way to know for sure.
What a joke.
All right, back into
Mario. Back into the cave. There we go.
Well, you know, they see these rays of light eventually in Dwarodelph, yeah. And they see a glimmer of blue sky. Sure. I thought I'd bring one of those to us.
Okay,
that's all.
Good.
That's
okay.
All. Okay.
Okay, the question is asked, who will lead us?
Yeah.
And again, Gandalf rising to the occasion, he will lead us.
Yep.
I honestly think this is the part where we can kind of get through some of they're trudging through, you know, Moria.
Sure, kind of quickly.
Yeah, kind of quickly. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Because there's significant things that happen along the way, but you're right. A lot of it is they're in this labyrinth, okay? And two of the people had been there before, Gandalf and Aragorn. Aragorn doesn't want to relive some of these memories, so he's not going to... And he didn't remember it as well as Gandalf. It sounds like Gandalf had a better time when he went through. Aragorn, not so much. So if you're going through a place and it's a bad memory, you're probably not going to tend to dwell on it too much and remember details.
For sure.
Whereas Gandalf has some memory and retained these memories of being through here. So
yeah.
So yeah, but for the rest of them, it's a bunch of... at first, especially, there's drop-offs. There's holes. There are paths that seem to lead one way or the other. But pretty much, you know, Gandalf also illuminates his staff here.
Yes, he does.
But just enough that he can see his...
Just right in front of
him. Right in front of him.
Yep.
Which is also amazing. I think we learn later here, too, that Gandalf can kind of see better in the dark. And as well as Gimli can.
Yep.
And so maybe that's a part of why he doesn't need as much light as well. And also why maybe Gimli... He kind of consults Gimli. Right?
He does.
Even though eventually it's pretty much he's the one who has the final say.
Yeah,
sure. he's kind of using Gimli as in his own council, sort of.
Yeah, kind of bouncing ideas off him. Because
he's GPS. He's Garmin.
I thought this was interesting because it would be sort of like, not that Gimli really knows where to go, but he understands dwarfs.
Yes.
And he understands structures.
True.
You know, it might be able to kind of like, you almost imagine, is that where they would have... What you call it over there? Is that where they would store this? Is this
right.
Take us down into
where is your Arby's?
You know, yeah. Where's your Arby's at? Where is there? Is there?
Well, I think you're on it. You're definitely on something there too. I mean, he's thinking. How does a dwarf think? I don't think like a dwarf too.
Right, and so it helps them get through the darkness. Yeah. I think a little bit. So
that's brilliant, man.
I mean, you can tell them where that path ends. That's just going to take you down to the living quarters.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Type of thing.
Yeah.
So
good point. Wow.
I don't know. I thought that's how he was using Gimli.
Yep.
So. Now it goes over there like their walking order, you know. As you had said in the beginning, Aragorn's bringing up the back, the rear, and he's just kind of doing his thing. They talk about their swords, which I thought was cool. When Gandalf pulls out his sword, that was neat.
Yeah, and we learned that his sword, along with Frodo's, glows blue when orcs are close too.
Yep.
They're made both, you know, from the ancient city of Gondolin,
made
by elves. So
the
pretty
Smiths
cool.
Smiths of elder days.
That's right.
You know,
my distant relatives, or ancestors, I should say.
Let's see. So, it talks about them, as you said, twisting around a few turns. They begin to descend.
Have we talked about the Miraver yet? How we'd like a sip of that Miraver?
Drink? That would be nice.
Out of the cordial. And he sort of rations that out, right?
He does. They get a little bit right here in the beginning.
Yep. This is their third sip.
Yeah.
They had some previously and then before the gate, right? Or at the gate or something. It was... Before, and it says a third sip of the Miraver of Rivendell after they had eaten. They kind of eat on this initial part. I guess I'm backtracking here.
No, you're right. You're right. You're right. No,
one thought drives out another.
So as they start, once they're in they need a little encouragement. So.
Yeah, that's right.
You're right.
Yeah, because actually Frodo eventually talks about this starting to wear off. He at this beginning portion, you know, it's probably just a rush of adrenaline from surviving that attack. They have a little food and drink. And it sustains them for a little bit, but they just keep going.
Mm-hmm.
And at some point, too, it also mentions that they're more wary of stopping and being in an unknown place than just keep trudging on. Even though they're exhausted, they'd rather keep moving than stop and rest because it's not very restful when they do stop.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
And you know, getting back to traversing. It's the decision making here, and it's all on Gandalf's shoulders.
Yeah.
It actually says the mines of Moria were vast and intricate beyond the imagination of Gimli, glowing son, dwarf of the mountain race, though he was.
Yeah.
So even though he understands maybe the structures, as I said, the vastness is kind of mind blowing.
Like,
right?
We've never seen this
and
before.
And he's heard tales of it and that kind of thing, but
he's never been there.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's a good point.
So now they're getting a little bit worried. You know, it's seeming it's gloomy. You know, it's going to be a long journey, right? And I think it's interesting that that Aragorn from the back says, "Do not be afraid."
Yeah, said it twice
with a long pause in between there, and he says, "Do not be afraid."
Come on, baby, bring
I have been with him on many journeys, if never on one so dark. And there are tales of Rivendell. There are tales of Rivendell of greater deeds of his than that I have seen. He will not go astray if there is a path to find. He will lead us. He has led us in here against our fears, but he will lead us out again at whatever cost to himself.
Again, some foreshadowing there.
Yeah. So so we got to trust in him, you know? Yep. You'd mentioned the fissures and the cracks and the places where
pitfalls,
you know, and Sam's wishing he had some rope because of those.
Yeah, that's right.
it's either Pippin or Merry. It takes them a bit to kind of get the courage to actually jump across one of them.
That's right. Oh my gosh, I missed that. Yeah Pippin. That's right. He says that, you know, I knew I'd want it if I hadn't got it.
Yeah.
Yep.
So again, to me, the next spot that I have on our checklist of things we need to get through this chapter, well, I have Gollum's footsteps.
Yes,
does that come up next?
Yeah, it's coming right up. So, you know, the dangers become more frequent, it says, and their march became slower. They were more than weary, and yet there seemed no comfort in the thought of halting anywhere. There you go. Frodo's, this is what I just said. Sorry, I was skipping the gun.
You're okay.
Jumping the gun. Frodo's spirits had risen for a while after his escape and after food and a draft of the cordial. But now a deep uneasiness growing to dread crept over him again. And this is where he starts to say, you know, his wound, he believes.
Yeah, yeah.
Is making his senses in the dark more heightened. And he can see more in the dark than his companions, save maybe Gandalf. And talking about the ring as well, becoming a heavy weight. We haven't really heard that yet. This is kind of the first time that we were realizing it is also a physical weight on Frodo. Felt the certainty of evil ahead and of evil following, but he said nothing. He gripped tighter to the hilt of his sword and went on doggedly.
So he senses the evil ahead.
Yes.
And he senses something ominous, evil behind them.
Right.
You know?
So, and Frodo had always been kind of attuned to these higher things.
Sure he has.
But this wound has made him more, I guess,
more in tune, I'd say.
Yeah, and maybe he's, even with darker powers.
Okay. Yeah.
More understanding, right? Of danger, of evil.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yep.
Yeah. But you're right. So up here, you know, he hears these,
the footsteps.
Faint fall of soft bare feet.
Yeah.
Which is very interesting.
Yeah. Well, because he talks about the heavy footsteps of his companions and things, then he hears.
Right.
It was never loud enough or near enough for him to feel certain that he heard it.
Yeah.
But once it had started, it never stopped.
Yeah.
So.
And then, you know, it's almost like this idea of them being tracked. Like when they do stop.
Yes.
It continues on for a couple more steps.
And it stops.
And then it stops.
Right.
And so, and he doesn't think anyone else can hear it, right? Is that what he's saying too?
Yeah. He
that
doesn't
it's just
think,
him
yes.
who senses it. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, again, I know they give a lot over to, you know, elves and their senses and their sight and their hearing, all that stuff. But the hobbits themselves are very keen in their sense.
Remember
of
what we
hearing? And,
yeah, what we talked about way back when Sam, we set out on this journey. They're heightened hearing.
Yeah. We know that they can move quietly.
Yep.
You know, and things like that.
Yeah.
And so you imagine if this is Gollum and Smeagol sneaking through.
Yeah.
And he's probably quiet like a hobbit because he, you know, descended close relation
pretty much
to the hobbits
purposes. Yeah, that's right.
So.
Yeah. So now we come to this point where there is a great arch and kind of three passages.
Right.
One on the left plunged down, the one in the middle went straight ahead, and the one on the right kind of went to the right and up. And Gandalf says, you know, I don't remember this place. No memory of it.
Yep.
Don't know which way to go.
The place of no memory.
Yeah, that's right.
And so he's weary, decides to sit down for a little bit, yeah. And you know, I think he says at this point he hasn't had a good smoke in a while. Is that this spot?
Yeah, it's so.
Or
it's,
is it coming up?
It's coming up here.
Okay, that's right. It's coming up.
Yeah.
So, anyways, is this where Pippin gets in trouble?
Yeah. So they have there's this little room off to the right that kind of offers them a little bit of shelter. They didn't feel real safe sitting on that stoop there, right out in the open. They wanted to kind of.
Oh yeah.
It used to be an old like guard station, pretty much for that area.
Yeah, and the Hobbit starts to go in, and it's Gandalf who was sort of. Like, you know,
yeah,
careful, don't go headlong in
right.
there.
Let me go first and make sure it's safe. That's yeah. right. And Aragorn even says, you know, or is that later where he says, you know, trust your leader. Can't remember. Anyway, mm-hmm. there's he says, let the guide go first while you have one. Right. So
yeah.
be thankful that you have a guide.
Yeah, while you have one.
Yeah.
Good old foreshadowing.
Man, he's sensing a big conflict coming and not wrongly. So yeah, it talks about Pippin's like fascination with this well. Isn't this weird?
I know this is weird.
It's yeah. almost I don't know if this power comes over him. He feels this irresistible urge, right, to go over to it, creeping yeah. over the edge of it.
But can we be honest? Have you ever had the urge to like?
Oh, dude, you know all the time, all the time. In high places, I'll look over the edge and I'm like, what would happen if I like? I often wonder like if oh, this is an appendices. Or an appendix. If I just jumped and ran out and jumped, what would people do? A, how would it feel? B, like would people go, no, what?
It's
just weird. I don't know what. I think it's like a root like of those, evil. Yeah.
Yeah, but it's those weird things. I've had those situations where I'm sitting there calm, patient, listening to somebody, and I was like, and you think in your mind,
just
you're
start
like,
yelling?
What if I just lashed out? Nuts, you know? I mean, I don't know. So that's kind of what
just
I thought this was.
Strange urges.
That's
right.
what I thought this was.
You know what? Yes.
And he
agree.
Acted on it.
Okay.
You know?
Okay, there you go.
Maybe not to the full extent. Maybe he was thinking, like, you need to
jump
down
right
there.
Down here. What would they do? What would they do? Well, and who even talks about, you know, he had almost could have fallen in.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, there you go. Sorry about that. Another sidebar from old Lane Smith there. He tosses a rock down in.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? And for a long time doesn't hear anything. You know, several heartbeats and no sound and then this plunk.
Yeah.
And Gandalf, like, you know, what was that?
Mm-hmm.
Pippin confessed right away, calls him a fool of a toque, so kind of like what happens in the films, but not exactly. And then they start hearing these faint knocks. Tom, tap, tap, Tom, tap, Tom, Tom, tap, tap, tap.
Yeah.
Right? And it sounds like some sort of signals, and then it's Gimli that says, that's the sound of a hammer if ever I heard one.
Yeah, but it still could be a signal.
Could be.
You know?
Right, to check up on something. Signal with a hammer. Yeah.
Because nothing's moving up by that well. That's going to cause a rock.
No.
To fall.
No.
Through there.
Exactly.
So
that pretty much alerts. Yeah.
Yeah. And if they picked something up off the ground, if someone was down there and they got the rock,
true.
You'd look at the ceiling and say, this is not something that fell from the ceiling.
Right.
You know?
Right. So Gandalf's hopeful it has nothing to do with Pippin's foolish actions, but rewards him anyway. He gives him the reward of having to take first watch.
Yeah.
Right.
Right. And they kind of go to that corner and they sleep a bit, but really, you know, Gandalf's laying there for a bit, and he can't sleep.
He's awake.
Yeah.
Right. He's deep in thought. And he decides he needs a little what?
Is that where he needs to?
Yeah. He can't. He's like, I don't know what's wrong with me. He sat down by the door.
That's where he needs to smoke.
He says,
right?
I need a smoke. So here's him kind of puffing away.
Yeah. I tasted it.
You know what?
Technical difficulties again?
I've got a sound effect of him actually puffing. I don't know what's going on here, man.
What's wrong with your phone?
I don't know, dude. You know what?
Seriously.
Volume was down.
Okay, why don't you play it again?
Do it again there, Gandalf. Sounds pretty accurate, right?
That's pretty accurate.
That's actually my daughter, Winnie. She's doing this puffing thing now, and ever since she's been doing it, all I think about is it sounds like Gandalf puffing on that pipe.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Just kind of... So yeah, gets a smoke in him.
Oh, here's a question. Are you going to let your daughter smoke a pipe when she's older?
Ooh.
Wow, on the spot.
Jeez, dude.
Your wife's in the next room, just so you know. I'm just kidding.
I know.
Don't answer that.
No, but this is a...
Don't answer.
I'll let it opt to think over it like you know,
just
because, I mean, some of my favorite characters in this book smoke a pipe.
I'm just...
So my daughter wants to smoke.
I mean, when she inherits the podcast years from now...
Holy crap, dude.
You know?
We're both dead. Or, yeah. Well, I'll be dead for sure.
Well,
You'll still be here.
Well, I don't know. You know, she'll be sitting here...
Smoking a pipe.
With a pipe, with, you know...
I guess as long as she turns the smoke detectors off first, I'm okay with it.
Okay, cool.
And does it once a week. Not a habitual thing. Dangerous.
Sorry. On the spot. All right. So good old smoke here to kind of get our nerves in order.
And they're sitting here a long time, dude.
Yeah. Yeah.
6 hours. And then just says, hey, I'm going to trust this way. It doesn't smell so bad.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then they're marching for 8 hours.
Yep.
I mean, we're getting the idea. This is a long march.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Starting to go steadily upwards. You know, the wizard's light is bobbing like a will-o'-the-wisps in front of them, kind of guiding them. And they're also saying this way was more traveled. There are these great mountain curves, and it rises higher and loftier, but there aren't as many chasms or cracks. It seems like it was a well-traveled, important road, and they start to move forward more quickly than they had in their first march. So,
yeah, he's pleased, isn't he?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Says that he's...
I chose the right way.
Yeah. Yeah.
So they continue on this way for about 15 miles in a direct line, but actually it's probably more like 20. And Frodo starts to feel his spirits kind of rise again.
Yeah.
But still, he's haunted by these sounds that he either hears or thinks he hears.
Isn't it neat, too, like the directions, right? So we start down.
Here's Ezra's compass again.
I really, he does a good job of explaining how.
He does.
We rise up the side of the mountain. Yep. We're in the mountain, right? We're rising. We're going up. Levels off a little bit.
Yep.
And then we have to rise again.
Right.
We chose right. And we're going to rise a little bit more. And then when he's in there, he says, you know, he's talking about the Dimrill Gate.
Yes.
You know, but we are high up, a good deal higher
than where we were. That's right.
So that's they want to get eventually. Well, is that where they were or is that where they're going? Is that the gate that they're going to? Is that what it's called?
Right.
The Eastern Gate? Yeah.
Yeah.
I thought that was
right. You're right. You're right. Yep.
But that made me think they're going up like this, level off, go up a little higher.
Yeah.
Now they're high enough to where the next part of their journey is going to have to be a descent.
Descent a little bit.
Yeah. Of some kind.
Yeah, you're right.
So.
You're right.
I don't know. It's just neat the way he guides us through.
It's amazing because Ezra's so in tune with directions and
not always, but
no, seriously, guys, he is a compass, right? And this is the guy talking right now, me, who I always think north is right ahead of me, right in front of me.
Well, isn't it?
Is it?
I don't know. Not sure.
So So when he starts going all these directions, I find my head spinning, and I'm like, okay, just tell me where we're trying to get to.
Yeah,
and I can imagine the twists and turns. But you're right. He does a great job of. He knew this. He had this place mapped out in his head.
Yeah.
He had it mapped out in his head. He knew exactly kind of the directions they had to go and the elevation. Because you're thinking, that is such a cool thought, too. Especially when they get to this, the realm of Dwarrodelph, too. Thinking about, you know, you're in a place that has all these elevation changes, but you're inside a mountain.
And that's where they are, really. That's basically where we're at right now. Yeah.
Yeah. It's incredible to think about because you just think like you're going this great distance, but you can be going vertical, you can be going down, you can be going sideways, around in circles. So you're actually not traveling as far as you think you are. Like, you know, they say that as the crow flies, it's 15, but really actually it was more like 20.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And how you could just get lost down there so easily.
Right. Yep.
Amazing.
For sure.
Yeah.
So as you said, we're in, what is it called again?
Dwarrodelph.
Dwarrodelph. Yeah. So that's actually where we're at. That's where we get to.
Yeah.
And, again, I've chose the right path. He lets out a little bit of the way it's described to when they first come in. There's just darkness pressing around,
and they
could feel that they had came out into an opening,
right?
Yeah,
and they feel kind of
the air,
the warm wind behind them, and then cold coming towards them, like implying a bigger space,
right? And this place is vast.
Huge.
I mean, huge.
Huge.
Gandalf puts off just enough light to where they can kind of see the three arches, the three doorways across the hall.
Yeah.
And that was enough. He didn't want to let off any more light, you know, just enough to kind of see over there. And then they end up kind of huddling up in the corner, hanging out, taking a nap.
Yeah, that's right.
So.
That's right. And
did you get scared when Gimli started in on his poem? I got nervous, actually, when I was rereading this. I'm like, Gimli, what? It's quiet, man. Hey, Gandalf doesn't want to shed
any
light.
Don't summon any
here.
Kind of stuff.
Why are you up talking this loud? You
know, he's up talking Tolkien.
He is.
That's all I know. Yeah, you know, I don't.
He made me nervous.
I didn't get that same sensation.
Okay.
All
right.
Maybe I probably misread it, like everything I do. As
no, you're
fine. Self-conscious here.
I was like, if it's so quiet, why in the heck are you?
Yeah. Well, here's why he does, right? Because Sam says, you know, what a dark place. You know, why don't they live in such? Why do they live in such a dark, dreary hole? And Gimli says, they're not holes. You know, don't compare it to a little hobbit hole, all right? This is a great realm, and it was full of light and splendor.
Right.
You know, as it's remembered in our songs. So I was sort of swept away into this tale. I was like...
Yeah.
I was blown away by...
It's one of those times where, like, where someone is, where they need a song, or they need something, or a chant, or a story told.
Sure.
Uplifts them a little bit, you know?
Yeah.
And it is a good moment for the dwarves.
And it gives us some history, and also kind of leads into what we're talking about next, the riches of Moria. Man, can we read this? Sure. We read this? The world was young, the mountains green, no stain yet on the moon was seen, no words were laid on a stream or stone when Durin woke and walked alone. I bet Tom woke him up. He named the nameless hills and dells. He drank from yet untasted wells. He stooped and looked in Miromir and saw a crown of stars appear as gems upon a silver thread above the shadow of his head.
Yeah. The world was fair, the mountains tall, in the elder days before the fall of mighty kings of Nargothrond and Gondolin, who now beyond the western seas have passed away. The world was fair in Durin's day.
A king he was on carven stone in many pillared halls of stone. Oh, gosh. A king he was on carven throne in many pillared halls of stone with golden roof and silver floor and runes of power upon the door. The light of sun and star of moon in shining lamps of crystal hewn, undimmed by cloud or shade of night. There shone forever fair and bright.
Their hammer was on the anvil smote, their chisel clove, the graver wrote. Their forge was blade and bound was hilt, the delver mined and the mason built, the barrel, the pearl, the opal pail, and metal wrought like fish's mail. Bucklers, corsets, axes, and swords and shining spears were laid in hoard.
Unwearied then were Durin's folk beneath the mountain. Unwearied then were Durin's folk beneath the mountains. Music woke. The harpers harped, the minstrels sang, and at the gates the trumpets rang.
Yeah. The world is gray, the mountains old, the forge's fire is ashen cold, no harp is rung or hammer falls, the darkness dwells in Durin's halls, the shadow lies upon the tomb of Moria in Khazad-dum, but still the sunken stars appear in dark and windless Miramir. There lies his crown in water deep till Durin wakes again from sleep. It's interesting. Yeah, it does harken back to the days of the greater things that times, they built, right?
Right. But then also how it's fallen.
Yeah.
Its glory is no more. And we get led into this, you know, are there a bunch of jewels here? Sam was asking, you know, what kind of riches did they have? And talks about how orcas. Yeah, the
flower, yeah.
The whales, you know, the orcas. How orcs had plundered it long ago, you know, but how the real riches.
We can't talk to them.
No, I'm having a hard time. How the riches of Moria were in this Moria silver, true silver, which the elves called Mithril.
Mithril.
How it's 10 times the worth of gold.
Dude, can you imagine for a second that they're describing this Mithril, right?
And
Frodo's sitting there like, holy smokes.
And then Gandalf reveals this, which is, this is cool because this is in the appendices or the additional scenes in the extended edition.
Yeah.
You know, and Gandalf says, I never told Bilbo. You know, he was given this Mithril shirt from Thorin. Gimli's like, that was a kingly gift. Wow. And Gandalf says, I never told Bilbo.
Yeah.
But the worth of that shirt is more than the Shire and everything in it.
Yeah.
And how cool is it too as a symbol? I've always, since I've heard this, I've always thought Frodo is literally carrying the worth of his home on his back.
Yeah.
Like it's a symbol obviously, and it's a value of money, but it's like, it's interesting that something as valuable as his home he's wearing.
Yeah.
And will protect him while he's trying to protect his home.
Yep. Crazy.
Onions, man. So many layers.
So,
but then he also says, this makes him think of the Shire, right? Mm-hmm. He says, I wish it was back home. Wish I didn't know about Moria, Mithril, or the Ring.
For sure.
Yeah, the good old days.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. So they do finally get a little bit of rest here, respite. And when they wake up, Gandalf talks about how you would know He talks about this dim light that could be seen, that they actually had like windows.
Yeah.
Great windows on the side of the mountain.
Like that skylights,
is,
man.
Dude, that is so freaking cool.
Isn't it trippy?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So you know, that's pretty neat. Frodo set up. Good morning, said Gandalf. For morning it is again at last. I was right, you see. We are high up on the crest, we're high up on the east side of Moria. Before today is over, we ought to find the great gates. And so I think actually you said this was who does the illustrations for this book that I'm reading? Is it Alan?
It's Alan Lee.
Alan Lee,
the master.
Yeah, and just some awesome, cool, like, you know,
that shaft
images,
of light.
The shaft of mm-hmm. light coming through type mm-hmm. of thing. So, yeah.
Also interesting here too that there were no sounds, right?
Mm.
Even the imagined echo of a footfall disappeared.
Hmm.
So hey, maybe even more evidence, obviously, that. Someone who is following them is following them. He's not having to move since they're not moving.
Yeah. So I here we go. So Gandalf's ready to get him started. We're tired, but we shall rest better when we are outside.
Mm-hmm.
I think that none of us will wish to spend another night in Moria.
Yeah.
And so I think they're going to try to get out of here in a day.
Yep.
Right.
Yep. Trying to get out. Yep.
So let's see here. Let's go towards that light in the north door.
Yep.
If we could find a window, it would help, but I fear that the light comes only down deep shafts. So they move on, and this is where we get into Balin's tomb. Mm-hmm. Is that right?
Yes, that's right.
Okay.
So they talk about just following his lead, the company passed under the northern arch. They see this large square chamber, dimly lit, but to their eyes, after so long a time in the dark, it seemed dazzlingly bright, and they blinked as they entered. You know, it's dusty. They're walking on something, even though they don't know what. It's kind of weird footing.
Yeah.
They see a small square patch of blue sky upwards through one of these shafts. The light of the shaft fell directly on a table in the middle of the room, a single oblong block about 2 feet high, upon which was laid a great slab of white stone. And Frodo says, you know, it looks like a tomb. And right. It is a tomb.
It is.
We've got some dwarven runes there, deeply graven. And Gandalf translates them for us.
Yeah.
Gandalf, go ahead.
Oh.
You're Gandalf.
Good. Glad to know that. These are Darren's runes, such as were used of old in Moria, said Gandalf. Here is written in the tongues of men and dwarves. Balin, son of Fundin, lord of Moria. He is dead then, said Frodo. I feared it was so. Gimli cast his hood over his face.
Some more of kind of interesting the difference there between in the film, right? It's Gimli who sees it, runs towards it, and then just starts bawling. And it's almost like it's this in the book, it's more like Gimli kind of knew. He kind of had this suspicion, mm-hmm. along with everyone else, that Balin wasn't, you know, wasn't still alive.
Well,
it's almost like this reserved mourning, right? He puts his hood up and he's like.
Actually, in the book, okay. They do a bit, because even you have the council where it's actually mentioned. We haven't heard. Gloin says we haven't heard from him in a long time,
right?
And that we had messages,
right?
But then we didn't,
right?
You know, so not good.
So kind of anticipated that probably,
yeah.
Moria fell. So now we know for sure, and that's where we're left hanging.
Yeah.
What will happen to our fellowship?
I
don't know, dude.
So the next chapter, is the Bridge of Khazad-dum,
right.
Which is. Lord have mercy.
Yeah.
Okay. So anyways, if you guys have thoughts on the chapter, let us know. It was a decent sized chapter, and there might have been some good little nuggets in it that we missed.
Stuff that we met, yeah.
So
we just couldn't cover, really,
because
we'd be here 4 hours. I loved that chapter. I loved it. And I love those ones that parallel the movie enough, but also give you enough nuggets.
I'm surprised at how much we got through, you know, in terms of like our journey. In one chapter.
Yeah.
You know, it really took us quite a ways.
You're right. Maybe the farthest yet.
Yeah, it's
maybe not in pure distance, but just in I guess we went from
Holland.
Right.
You know, and we're well up into, you know, Moria.
Right. So, almost out.
Almost out.
Yeah.
So
I agree. It feels like one of the most diverse chapters we've had so far. And our fellowships all together. We've got this dynamic of all these characters. Yeah. You know, it's our first chapter we've had a huge development with Gandalf. Gandalf has, we've seen his power kind of come to the, all we've heard, you know, we've obviously experienced it in The Hobbit, but all we've heard is these stories about Gandalf. And so far he's, you know, this guy who does fireworks, and we hear stories of him being this great, you know, hero, but we haven't really seen it yet with our own eyes.
Yeah.
And now on top of that hill, we get a glimpse of it. And then him, him bravely going into this dark and only path left and leading us and doing it the right way.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. It's epic, man.
It is pretty neat.
Gotta be one of your favorite characters or one of your favorite chapters for that reason.
Yeah. Right? I like it a lot because you do get his leadership and things, you know, and him kind of pressing to the front, and taking this bigger leadership role before the Bridge of Khazad-dum. So big deal. And it's and it is kind of we're building. You can tell it's we're building towards something, get some scary moments here and there, but we're in the dark now.
Yeah.
And we've been warned about this. Mm-hmm. Aragorn, you know, warns Gandalf. Mm-hmm. And you can clearly see he's out in front. He's the one, you know, doing what he needs to do. This is his great trial coming up. So it's crazy. It's also, it is just to me, like, I mean, honestly, I meant what I said when I talked about when they walked into that great open vast hall. It's scary. I don't know what's in the corner.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if there's like things coming out from the sides or if there's, I don't know. I can't see.
So I guess one of the things we skipped over too was after Pippin, when he was on watch, he had this phantom feeling like something was going to climb up that well and come get him. So would you rather be in that position or in that great realm of Dwero Delph?
Yeah.
With the possibility of a big space where anything could be just around the corner. What would you rather be?
Dang, that's crazy to think about.
Because I think I'd rather be in the big space, off in a corner, quiet. Because I have a fear of that too, like something just creeping up out of nowhere. Like there's a hole there, you know?
Well, here's the thing. I guess if you're in a tight space like that, I'm kind of afraid of that.
Confrontation's coming.
Where can I go to?
You can't.
You know, I can't outrun them. I can go back down a narrow passageway.
The door's closed behind
that's
you.
That's also what makes me nervous sometimes when they get in those narrow passageways and things.
Because you could bump right into somebody. An orc band. You could bump right into it. Or something worse.
Yeah, exactly. So you could be kind of pressed in on both sides, you know, for example. So, okay, all right, friends. Well, we made it through. I don't know how we're doing on time, but we'll be okay. We are into let's get into the Bywater Post.
Let's do it.
We had a little nugget earlier in the episode.
That's right.
And I think it's time to kind of go
hear the rest of Gollum's story.
So here we go. You know, this is. Should we say who it's from first, or should we just read the story? Let's read. You will tell you who it's from here at the end. How Middle-earth. So the title of this is How Middle-earth Has Affected Me. Like many people my age and generation, I discovered Lord of the Rings from the Peter Jackson films. I had never read the books, and all I remembered at first were the trailers of some, you know, hermit-like old guy asking Elijah Wood, "Is it secret? Is it safe?"
Yeah,
That's awesome. Actually,
it is.
I was bewildered by this and not sure. If this was a horror movie or not. Months later, my mother, cousin, and I went to go see Fellowship of the Ring at Great Lakes Crossing in Auburn Hills, Michigan. I found it pretty funny that my cousin had to use the restroom, and by the time he got into the theater, he couldn't find us. So he had to sit
alone. Talk about a journey in the dark.
Wow. He had to sit alone with strangers. Because those were the days, man, where you couldn't reserve your seat. And
no one really had cell phones either. That you could just shine to
and
see
you
where you're
going.
And you
could try to maybe put your jacket there for somebody, but it's up in the air, man.
Yeah.
If somebody really pushy comes through, like, sorry, man.
Seat's gone. That guy
was kind of a jerk, so.
Damn. Yep.
My Hufflepuff nature just kind of gave in.
I don't know what that means.
Sorry, it's for all the people from Social Flick.
Potterheads?
Yeah, Potterheads.
Okay.
So anyways, he says, but, you know, so he sat alone with strangers for 3 long hours. I must admit that the first movie was a little boring for me, but I also wanted to know what happened next. Mm-hmm. Surely this movie wasn't all about walking in the woods. I tried to read Fellowship of the Ring, but just couldn't get into it. I went back, I went back each of the 2 years to see, the Two Towers and Return of the King and loved it. This may be my introduction to the world of Middle Earth, but what grabbed me was as a junior in high school.
Hmm.
Okay. So here we're going to get into a little story instead of a story here. My buddy from high school, Brian, Solomon.
Yeah.
Thank you. Would constantly be doing voices at the beginning and end of class. Wow, I kind of have a buddy who was like that as well. Always doing voices. You know, sitting right across from me now. I mean, always.
Those are the voices in my head, though.
That's right. But yeah. So he would do Gollum or Smeagol, and I also wanted to do it as well.
Yeah.
I've dabbled with voice impressions and doing my own voiceover, you know, character shows on my laptop prior to this.
That's so cool.
That is pretty neat. It was him and the character of Smeagol that really got me into pursuing it seriously. For the rest of that semester, I began working on the voice of Smeagol. And over the course of 3 years, I feel that I have perfected it. And I would say, as we heard earlier, yes.
Pretty spot on.
Absolutely.
Andy Serkis might be calling you for tips.
Yeah, for real. So this experience of diligent voice impressions discipline has helped me with other character voices that I create and hone. It has been so beneficial to me that I was able... that has allowed me to be cast in an independent video game.
That is so cool, man.
Now, that's epic.
It's like Mark Hamill.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Yeah.
God, wow. That'd be so awesome.
Yeah.
All right, so you want to read the rest of this here?
Sure. We got to know what video game that is, by the way.
Yeah.
We got to know. The other side of this is that in real life, I am a professional counselor and love doing what I do. My favorite and most powerful moment in counseling so far has a Lord of the Rings connection to it. When working at a homeless shelter in Dallas, Texas, I would see people from varied backgrounds. One person I had the pleasure of working with was a 20-something and felt shunned by his family. He was always working on a comic book he wanted to publish or just to create for his own satisfaction. Suffice it to say, he loved speaking in word pictures. He had painted his own words with his words. This landscape of a house in a rural desolate area with Mount Doom in the distance. He loved talking about Lord of the Rings and other high fantasy stories. He at one point said, "I can't do this anymore. I can't carry what I am carrying anymore. It's too much." Looking at his tear-filled eyes, I said to him, "You are Frodo and I can be your Sam." Wow. "I may not be able to carry it for you, but I can carry you." He looked up at me with a smile and tears streaming down his face and said, "You get me." That was the day of breakthrough for him, and within a month or two, we were able to end counseling, and he was able to move out of the homeless shelter, work at a hospital, and get his own place.
Wow. Wow.
So as a little sidebar here too, that's the power of storytelling, right?
Yeah.
That's what it can do for people. A shared experience, a shared story where you may not have anything else in common can lead to a breakthrough for people.
Yeah.
This is amazing.
Yep.
Guys, this still gives me goosebumps. I think we're feeling them too right now too. When I think about it or write about it as a counselor, that is how I picture myself. I picture myself as Sam going with a bunch of different Frodos on a journey to their own Mount Doom to help them let go, get rid of, destroy whatever it is that is burdening them. Wow. This is my first for real official read through, and I gotta say, I love it. I started about a year and a half ago, and this has really encouraged me to keep up with the chapters. I read about a quarter to a half a chapter each night before bed. I am so glad that my dear friend Rachel McCulley told me about this podcast. So cool. We haven't heard of a friend connection like that yet. Cool. That is sweet.
That's awesome.
So thank you, Rachel. I am enjoying the fellowship that Ez and Lane put together. I am sorry for the length of this. Keep on keeping on. Remember, this is some good. There is some good in this world, and it's worth fighting for.
Yeah.
In fellowship, I'm Chase telling you. McKinney. And Chase, I mean,
so that was Chase, guys.
Yeah, that was
Chase. And Chase has been real active in the group and things, and just. Here's the thing. I mean, this makes sense because everything I've seen, you know, you kind of get a vibe or a feel, a sense from how people write in the group and what they say and stuff. And it's always positive.
Yeah.
You know, and the fact that he's a counselor and he's a Sam.
Yeah.
He's a Sam. He's someone who picks people up, you know, and helps them, you know, along life's journey. That's epic.
And that analogy too, because I would imagine counseling is a little bit like teaching, especially probably especially, you know, our role within a school as intervention specialists is there's a lot of social, there's a lot of emotional, like instruction and also just conversation that happens.
Yeah.
And how cool of him to develop this, imagery, this visual, this symbol.
Yeah.
Because jobs like that, I mean, a lot of jobs can, I'd argue most jobs, or if not all jobs can feel so burdensome can just carry on and drag on.
Yeah.
And you start into something in a line of work with a lot of passion. And as the years drag on, you become, you know, like everything else in this life, it seems like, unless you fight against it, hardened and maybe distant and more disillusioned. But to tie it to a story he loves so much and a character he loves so much in order to keep it at the front of his mind as a noble quest and journey that is a responsibility for good, that is worth fighting for, that only makes him a stronger counselor. That only helps the people he counsels. And honestly, like Ez was saying, we felt it within our group. And I'm sure all of you guys that have interacted with Chase and all of you are so good at this.
I mean,
you know, in injecting positivity and you know, encouraging us along this journey, this fellowship. I mean, this story was amazing. Just amazing.
Yeah, yeah, it really was. And it's kind of like, you know, the idea that you can find something, you know, to connect with somebody, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Whether it is Lord of the Rings or whatever, it's just like there's what's neat that is that internally, this is something that, you know, he kind of views himself in this regard of like Sam helping people do different things or whatever. I do that sometimes. I know you've done this in your life where what
Aragorn. WAD.
Yeah.
Yep.
What would Aragorn do?
Sounds like a joke, but it's serious.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, it's real. One of your favorite characters that drives you, you know, motivates you to do better and to do good in the world around you.
Yeah.
Yep. You know, and so,
and that's how a story can become real.
Yeah.
All right. And that's how a story
100%.
Yeah. And that, and I guess really, I mean, as an author, your goal in creating a story is that it would help that story become real in a way, right? That story would live. And this is how it lives in those connections to those characters and in that remembering, okay, what would Sam do?
Yeah.
What would Aragorn do?
Uh-huh.
What would Gandalf do? Right. And then to base your decisions around the nobility and the goodness of that character.
Yeah.
Dang.
It's why we do it, man.
That's it. That's exactly why.
It's really cool. So,
yeah.
But hey, Chase, honestly, thanks a lot.
Chase.
That's really cool. And what a great impression.
Yeah. Let us know that video game, by the way.
Yeah.
That you're involved in. Cause that is really, really cool. That's, amazing.
Yeah. Really neat.
Yeah. He did a great job. And can you be a voiceover, body double, because he could like double for Andy Serkis, man.
He totally could.
If he ever came down with a cold, it'd be like, hey, call in Chase.
Yeah.
We need some columns.
My real question is, can he do a Snoke impression since he can do a Smeagol?
Whoa. Or Caesar?
Sorry, Chase. Yeah, that too. Whoa. Yeah, yeah. That would be neat. Yeah. Gosh,
wow.
That's cool.
All right.
So anyways, anywho. Yeah. Now, I want to mention just another quick plug for the Bywater Post. Mm-hmm. I've got... We are stacked. The cool piece here. Lane and I had debated, you know, back in the day how we were going to do Bywater Post or whatever. As they come in, I've got a spreadsheet and I'm just kind of like ticking them off. I jumped ahead to work on Chase today just because he had sent us the audio clip and stuff and kind of stood out. And we wanted to get there. But if you've sent those to the email, they are on the list. So I've got them all laid out for episodes to come. So sometimes we'll do one an episode. Sometimes we'll do one or two. At max, we'll do three.
I think, you know, this is kind of a good rhythm we found, and you found a good formula for making it happen, and people have responded and sent their stories to one place that we can keep track of and go through systematically. And I think we kind of hoped at one point like people would call in and use that voicemail thing, but maybe it's I don't know, maybe it's more appropriate that they send their words in and then we read it. Maybe that's better for you guys too. Like I was thinking about myself. I'm like, would I want to call in and share my own story? Some people do and will.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know if I'd feel comfortable doing that, honestly. Like I'm, you know, if I was, I, you know, show, other podcasts that I listen to, I don't really necessarily interact with so much because I just like listening.
Yeah.
And I don't know if I would call in and share my story that way. So maybe this is what's best for everyone. And if people want to send in their audio story of them saying it, we would love to play it.
We will play it.
Yeah. Right. We will.
Yeah.
And I think instead of just, cause at one time we had talked about like standalone episodes that were Bywater Posts.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I liked that idea at first. But well, I don't anymore. And I think it was my idea, so that's probably why.
No. To me, it's like this nice. You have to be a little.
It's a segment of the, of our podcast, of our book club.
Yeah. It's one that we look forward to. I know you look forward to it, and I do as well. And to know that our email box is just loaded full of these.
Snowed under, man.
It is amazing. And I honestly sometimes will read a few of them as, and we catch a couple on Facebook, and just I kind of send myself an email and put them, in order there. But it's just, it takes a lot, I think, sometimes to share these stories.
Deeply personal.
Yeah.
Yeah, it does. There's a lot of bravery.
And it actually connects a lot of us in different ways.
Yeah, it does.
You know, so it's, you know, I think we had somebody, you know, last week who, we've had multiple weeks where people are kind of like, I'm not sure if this is appropriate for the podcast or whatnot, but, I kind of want to share. And those are sometimes the ones that, like, someone else is going to connect to that story.
If you want to share it, it's appropriate.
Yeah.
Right? That's the only thing that we want to limit is if you don't want us to share it, we're not going to. If you want to share it, it will be shared.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So just good stuff. We'll,
absolutely.
We've got, Aaron next week. We're gonna read Aaron's. It's quite a long one. We'll pair that with a smaller one.
Yeah.
You know. And there's no length on these guys. So send us your story. Yep, you know, we love it. So, all right. Yeah. Let's dive into strawberries.
Strawberries with cream, boy.
Goodness.
Okay. So we get to see Moria in a shadow of its former majesty. If you could visit one realm or city as in its prime, where would you go and why? I always type a little something too that's just for as
inside joke, yeah.
And it's just kind of,
the doc is ridiculous.
See if I can make him laugh.
Yeah,
it works like 50% of the time. So I'm thinking about there are a lot of ruins in Middle Earth. Yeah. So if you could see one of those places in its prime, and I know what you're gonna say.
Really?
I know yours.
What is it?
No, I want you to say it first. Then I'll be like, yeah, I know.
No, because then you're gonna just say.
Like, well, you have this fascination with Gondolin.
How the heck, man?
See, bingo. Daddy, no.
How did you know that?
I just knew.
I guess that's our talking around the fire stuff I always talk about.
Well, I mean, don't discredit my knowledge there.
No, that's friendship. What I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. We talk around the fire, and it's, and I often do.
I pay attention to the details, that's.
Bring up those stories. Yeah.
Yeah.
Gondolin would be neat to see. Yeah. And I actually kind of thought perhaps it. I thought that might be something we would see if we did the show. Right. You know, I kind of thought they might go back. I guess
we don't know what it's going to be about. So,
but
we got some time to speculate on that.
I'm interested to hear yours because I have no idea.
You know what? I'm throw it out there. I wrote this and didn't even think about it.
Oh, okay.
You thought I was going to say something funny there. You know what? Honestly. I think the ruins I'm most fascinated with, and maybe it's just because it's the tie to Strider and Aragorn, is the Watchtower of Amon Sul. And I think it'd be really cool because we don't really see anything like that.
Yeah, okay.
In the Third Age, it's all of our watchtowers, quote unquote, are all places that are part of a city. It's ingrained to the function of the city, and it's really honestly to protect that city.
Yeah. Okay.
There's no like outposts where it's like, hey, this is just a watchtower, but it also looks really cool. And there's some guys that live here, and it's to protect a wider realm.
Yeah.
And so I would have liked to have seen that, maybe another place too.
You're right. That's cool. Actually.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a cool one.
To see what it would have looked like in its glory. You know, how did the watchers in that tower, I guess there's a Palantir there. Wasn't there?
Was there?
God, people are going to hate us because I can't remember exactly. I think for some reason that they're... Look it up for me real quick. I'm going to babble some more.
Sure.
I think there was a Palantir there. Anyway, like what would it have looked like? You know, the banner of Gondor flying from the top. I don't know. Just interesting. Was there a wall that went along with it? Was there a structure down at the base of the hilltop? I don't know. I wonder about
that.
Well,
it's neat to...
There's another place too, though.
Okay.
That I thought would be kind of cool is the island of Numenor.
Oh, yeah.
That would be awesome. I mean, like the whole thing of how it's, you know, destroyed, kind of like Atlantis. You know, what would that have been like? It's in the shape of a star.
Yeah.
You know, was there a great wall around it? Was what did the castles look like? What was their architecture? You know, all these people, you know, have all these artists have all these renderings of what architecture of different cultures looked like. You know, like what, you know, men have a certain type of, especially when you look at Minas Tirith and Minas Morgul, you know, like a certain style. What would that have, what would that ancient style have been on Numenor? Like how much of that did they bring with them?
Yeah.
I don't know.
It's interesting. I know I know that the stones, the seeing stones.
Yes.
What I did know beforehand, I wasn't sure about the watchtower, but that they were used in the northern and the southern kingdom to kind of communicate. We had mentioned that.
Cell phones.
Yeah. Before. Skype. You know, some of them get lost actually though. But I don't really see anything.
Okay, that was
No. You could be right, man.
Well, I don't know.
There's a lot to kind of read, though.
It doesn't really matter. I just don't want people to get upset if I didn't remember.
We tried.
I'm a hobbit. I'm still a hobbit.
We gave it our best. So.
Well, that was pretty cool. So Gondolin, Numenor, and especially Aman Sul.
Yeah.
Those would be cool places to see, man.
Yep.
Very cool.
Maybe someday. Yep.
You know, when Morgoth returns, we got to fight him. He's coming back, guys.
He's coming back.
You think that's a joke? It's not.
It's not a joke. He's coming. But we'll be ready for him. All right.
Wait, Morgoth or Melkor? Which one?
They're the same.
Yeah, I knew that.
Okay.
How about we share the load?
Love,
shall
share
we?
The load.
Shall we?
So, yeah, okay, we always do our Patreon series. I actually uploaded two of them here for you guys in July. So we've got one where it's just complete random. Lane is possessed by various voices and things, and it's all about a toaster.
I like the term possessed.
You should
inspired.
Yeah, whatever.
Okay.
Something.
Okay.
You should check that one out. A lot of fun. Thanks to Swish and Flick for sharing that on your guys' group.
Oh yeah.
We really appreciate it. Yeah. So
sorry you lost a few members of your book club because of it.
Yeah,
but it's the risk you run with comedy.
Funny. It's so funny because Sarah, you know, is also struggles with the inner voices and
possession.
Stuff
yeah.
up there too. So. But anyways, we have some fun stuff on there this month. Actually, I think the second to last week in July. So that will be basically the week that you guys hear this, that coming week mm-hmm. after that Sunday. We are going to sit down together and we're going to start with Beren and Luthien. We're going to go over it and we'll probably try to release that by that Friday. Yeah. So by the end of the third week of July.
Yeah. So Hobbit's Guide is coming very, very soon.
Hobbit's Guide, get that going because we got to get ready for the Fall of Gondolin.
That's right. It's coming out at the end of August.
Yeah.
Something else.
Yeah.
Can't remember.
No, the only other thing in there is just t-shirts and stuff. I want people to hop into to that other tier if you guys want a t-shirt and some neat stuff we've got coming out.
Remember what I was going to say. We will get back to, I don't want people to think that we just something we started and we're never going to finish. We are going to get back to A Journey Through Middle Earth, the travel pod. There are currently two episodes up that detail kind of the journeys I've been fortunate enough to have in New Zealand. It's just honestly, guys, we've been so busy with going to a once a week format, trying to get some other kind of appendices materials up, and then also starting this histories too. We thought we were gonna have all this time in the summer. We've been busier.
Oh man, it's unreal.
We haven't really had a time to sit and get a bunch of stuff recorded at one time. It's all been like a day here, a day there, 3 days in a row. So anyway, I have it all laid out for chapter three. Actually, I put all the pictures in the photo album way back in.
Oh, cool. We'll link it again.
April.
Yeah.
But we're gonna pick that back up and get rolling through that. There are nine chapters that we need to get through and we're gonna do it. So
yeah, that's awesome.
Fun.
I think that week I want to come over here and just camp out. So we can get a bunch of stuff done. So,
you want to sleep outside?
Tell Goldberry I'm sorry.
She'll be cool with that.
I'll be here.
He will love it too.
Yeah.
Okay, I guess it's time for weekly well wishes, formerly Fortnite farewells. We want to thank you for stepping off the road with us. Our next episode, we'll be digging deep into chapter V,
mm-hmm.
or 5,
yep.
of book 2, The Bridge of Khazad-dum.
That's right. If you like our podcast, don't forget to subscribe, like us, write a review, leave a comment, or send us a shadow fax.
We'll see you in a Hobbit fortnight, or as it's also known, a week. And remember, Frodo lives. I just came up with that.
Yeah, you're...
It's a halfling. A week is a half of a fortnight.
Oh my gosh, that's genius.
Hobbit fortnight. That's what we're doing now.